gentlemen, the show is about to start in 10, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1.
He'll be fine on the mountain.
It's time for Inside the Gamecocks, the show. Built by the Barnuminium Company, served by Chicken Cock Whiskey, and part of the Chiefs Sports Network.
Touchdown, Carolina! Touchdown, Ace Sanders! Pressure! Penny just dives in!
All right, greetings and good morning. Welcome aboard and welcome home. Inside the Gamecocks, the show, live from the Signorama Studios, the preferred sign partner of your South Carolina Gamecocks. Built by the Barndo Co., the Barndominium Company is where you can build your dream home in the Carolinas and in Georgia and in Tennessee. If you are going to be doing that in the future, maybe that's one of your dreams. I would check them out, the Barndominium Company. And our friend Alicia Fields and TJ and all the gang, they are fantastic. And, of course, served by Chicken Cock Bourbon. Chicken Cock is actually bought a new bottle yesterday, as a matter of fact. And we're really happy to be partners with them. Chicken Cock Bourbon, you can find it in the Chief Sports app. JB, JC, and Phil here until 2 o'clock today. Pat Bradley with the SEC Network will join us at about 1 o'clock. And we will recap last night's loss for South Carolina as Tennessee came into the CLA and earned the 2023-2024 Southeastern Conference regular season championship by splitting the season series with the Gamecocks. They have earned it. The end of their season was going to be rough, and it's been anything but. The Vols have been playing exceptionally well, and they did for the most part last night. We will speak with Brad Muller at noon. He'll be calling the SEC tournament for the ladies up in Greenville. Beginning tomorrow, South Carolina looking to win their 8th in 10 trips to this sucker, or 8th in their last 10, I should say, under Dawn Staley. We've got some Gamecock baseball on deck as well. They did win yesterday in a rain-shortened ball game against Davidson. Longwood is on deck this weekend for that program. Stuart Lake will join us tomorrow to take a deep dive into what South Carolina really needs to do offensively to try to get things going. And we'll get to some football today as well. We were anticipating a pretty big announcement earlier this week. It looks like that's going to come tomorrow per JC. I think today the news will be out, but we will address it tomorrow on our show. It's something good for the University of South Carolina, and JC will be able to really fill you in on all that stuff. But guys, it was a tough night for South Carolina. You know, you felt like there were times where maybe they could pull this thing together and not only get back into it, but you know, feed off the energy of that 18,000 sold out Colonial Life Arena and maybe overcome some of what had been a little bit frustrating. At the end of the day, Phil, and at the end of the day, JC, it came down to one thing and one thing only. All the credit in the world goes to a class act in Rick Barnes. He's just outstanding as a basketball coach. Dalton Connect should probably be the first pick in the draft. I don't care who's projected. This kid is ridiculous. But it came down to one thing. South Carolina had some wide open shots that they didn't hit, and they had to hit those in order to win a game of this magnitude, and they did not hit them, particularly in the first half. I know some people were frustrated with the amount of threes that they took, understandably so. But let's remember this. A lot of those threes were open. You got to hit them. I mean, if you're going to be, if you're going to win the Southeastern Conference Championship, you know, you can't just pass up wide open 3-point shots. You got to take them and you've got to hit them. That's what Kentucky does, and Alabama and Auburn and Tennessee and South Carolina just couldn't get it done early on. But the season is far from over, hopefully. 24-6 now are the Gamecocks, 12-5 in the league, and really, really need to go win in Starkville this weekend. Right now they would be the 4 seed, so to secure that, they're going to need to win and hopefully not have to rely on anybody else. But pull for the Vols to beat the Cats this weekend up in Knoxville. And with that said, I will defer my time to the gentleman in the Titan Construction hat, Beanie.
Heck yeah, Titan Construction, tighten up, baby. Woo! Yeah, just to follow up with JB was talking about, like, right after we get off here, go to thebigspur.com, pay attention to Twitter, because that announcement is coming at 2. Right. In fact, I may have to jump off like 20 minutes early today, just as a programming note. You're like, where is JC? If I jump off during the show, I'm handling business, right? Gamecocks couldn't quite do it last night. You're right. Especially the first half, 4-17, 4-18 from the field for 3-point land. A lot of them were wide open. You know, Zach Davis, you know, I thought settled for outside shots quite a bit, was not the guy that we've seen the last two games driving in. And a lot of that had to do with Tennessee now. It's not, I'm not coming down on Carolina's players here. They're good. They're the best team in the SEC. They've been that way most of the year. They've backed it up by beating everybody. I mean, they've won at Rupp. They've won, they beat Auburn. They won at Rupp. They won in Columbia. They won in Tuscaloosa. They're good. I mean, legit. Say what you want. They're really, really good. You know, but Cooper, gosh, it was 40-34 to start the second half. Cooper misses a wide open one. That would have brought it back to 3. You know, you still have a chance there at the end, 60-56. They finally missed a free throw. Poor Meechie gets the rebound, and he was in the zone, and gosh, just gets in the lane and turns it over. You can't have that. You can't have 62-56 making one of 2 free throws when you get fouled. If you want to pull that out and dig out of the hole. Now, I do think South Carolina showed a lot of fight. I'll remind everybody, I'll go back to the Darren Horn year. South Carolina's really good at home. They won the East that season. Tennessee came to town. I think Bruce Pearl was the coach then. Dick Vitale, Bobby Knight calling the game. I remember Bobby Knight was out at spring football practice. You know, that one kind of meant something at the time. I think as far as division standings, and certainly the Gamecocks needing a quality win to get in the big dance, Tennessee took them to the – it was 20-point. It wasn't even a game. You know, they blew them off the floor. You know, you remember Frank's team that went to the NIT. You know, Kentucky comes to town. Calipari gets thrown out. Kentucky blew them off the floor. There's been times where this program's had a big home game, not quite this big, through the years where they've fallen behind, gotten nervous, and just imploded. These guys did not play their normal, you know, for this team to win, they have to hit outside shots. You know, not all, not 80%, you have to be red hot, but they got to hit their share. That's what it's designed. That's what the whole offense is designed to do. Hit your share of threes, you know, make people guard you out there, drive, that kind of thing. And Tennessee just, they were shutting down the inside, so you had to settle. And then if you're not hitting them, you know, it's kind of like when you can't complete a pass in football and they're loading up to stop the run. You know, that's kind of, for you helmet heads out there like me, that's kind of how I look at it. But the Gamecocks came back even when, you know, they cut it to 6 and then they couldn't hit the 3, and Tennessee ended up getting up by 14. Carolina still rallied, you know, and got it within 3. They're within striking distance. They had the ball down 4. Mm-hmm. With a minute to go, anything can happen in that situation. They just couldn't quite get it done. I still think there's an awful lot to take away from this game and this season, because, you know, you look at it every time, you know, the Auburn game being kind of that outlier in the second half against Bama. This team's brought it every single game, win or lose. And, you know, sometimes when you're in a league like this, the margin for error, no matter who you're playing, is very thin. And you go back to those missed free throws against Georgia, and it's painful to say, and a blown lead against LSU, we're not even having this conversation because it's pretty much, you know, Tennessee can only come back and tie or whatever. But look, man, you got the SEC tournament. That's a place that's been a house of horrors for the Gamecocks. I'm not sure what seed they'll get. Probably, I think, 4 or 5. I don't think they can go any lower than 5 because, at worst, it's a 3-way tie with Florida and Kentucky, and Carolina's beating those teams.
They could technically finish as the 6th seed, but that would require Carolina to lose and then Kentucky and Auburn to win and Arkansas to upset Alabama.
Oh, so there is a path.
But look, Arkansas.
If all the favorites hold.
At the end of the day, Kentucky needs to lose. Like, guys, yeah. Here's the two most likely scenarios, okay? These are the two most likely scenarios. If Auburn and Alabama are not losing. Auburn's got Georgia at home. Alabama's got Kentucky at home. I mean, Alabama's got Arkansas at home. They're going to win. If South Carolina loses, but Kentucky wins, okay, the Gamecocks would be the 5th seed. If South Carolina loses and Kentucky loses, the Gamecocks would be the 4th seed because they would be tied with the Wildcats and the Gators, but they'd have the 2-0 head-to-head record against them at 12-6. So if Kentucky loses and South Carolina wins, the Gamecocks are the 4 seed. So here's my point. Carolina needs to win the game, and Kentucky needs to lose. And if Carolina loses, Kentucky needs to lose. That's really what it comes down to.
Yeah, because it also, if Kentucky finishes tied with Florida, they lost to the Gators in Rupp. And so they lose that tiebreaker too, and that keeps them out of your bracket. I would much rather the Gamecocks play Florida again, as good as Florida's playing, than have to play Kentucky in Nashville in front of 10,000 screaming Wildcat fans. Gators won't travel as well. And that's if Carolina's 4 or 5. I think those matchups, you always want to get the double bye for sure, but this year you're going, you know, unless you were the 1 or 2, you're going to play a really good team most likely on Friday. And whether that's Kentucky, Florida, Auburn, Bama, you know, whoever. So, you know, I don't know. To me, you also kind of look at it, and if you're the 5th seed, you play the winner of Vanderbilt and Arkansas. And you know, Arkansas is a pretty dangerous group if they get their crap together, you know. So there's really no good matchups, I think. If you were the 1 seed, you're probably looking to play at LSU or Ole Miss or somebody. But it's they're no good matchups. But I would much rather take my chances if I'm the Gamecocks with some team other than the Wildcats up there, because they do tend to turn it on in tournament time and things like that. But, you know, it's just one of those things. I just, you know, it just didn't go Carolina's way. Credit Tennessee. Give them all the credit in the world. Give Carolina a lot of credit for fighting tooth and nail. And you have to understand that, you know, yeah, the SEC championship's gone, but there's a tournament in Nashville. You can go get after it. And there's also the big one, the big dance, which everybody remembers. And Jimmy Dykes said at the end of the broadcast, he thinks South Carolina's a Sweet 16 type team.
Yeah.
So, you know, and Jimmy Dykes knows what he's talking about. So there is more basketball to be played. There's more to the story. You know, there's still a school record for wins out there. Everything else for this team, it just it wasn't meant to be. And I'll say this too. Tennessee was locked and loaded. They had a great game plan. And I'll say this. I think that them knowing that they were one win away from winning the whole thing, and then it didn't matter what happened with Kentucky, I think that made a difference kind of in their focus. If they just still had work to do, you know, we got to beat South Carolina, then we got to beat Kentucky, maybe you catch them looking ahead to a mammoth senior day game with a title on the line against the Wildcats. But they knew they could come in, and if they wanted, they'd shut it down. And they did, and they came out, and, you know, I think South Carolina took their best shot. I think South Carolina took as good of a shot from them as they've given any team this year. Gamecocks got up off the mat, But like I said, it just wasn't meant to be. And hey, you know, the SEC championship's gone. So you chase that next year. Now it's the tournament, and now it's the big dance. So get ready. All hope is not lost. You know, Mississippi State's an important game for seeding. They're good. You know, that's a tough one. But go out there, play your best, try to get some momentum, and it's time to rock and roll with the big dance the following week, or the tournament and then the big dance.
Yeah, no question. Yeah, Phil, I mean, it's, you know, some points to be made, you know, on the outcome of the game last night. Again, congratulations to the Vols. They have absolutely earned this thing. I mean, they have not lost since they got tripped up on the road in College Station, and since then they've won seven straight, and that includes three straight over 11th-ranked Auburn, on the road at 14th-ranked Alabama, and on the road at 17th-ranked South Carolina, where the Gamecocks really had them playing the game that they wanted to play. I'm just going to continue to hit this. It's just not that complicated. Carolina didn't hit the shots they needed to hit. I mean, they went out to Tuscaloosa and hung 81 on them. They hung 92 on the Auburn Tigers. They hung 103 on Kentucky earlier in the year. They averaged 64.5 points per game in two contests against South Carolina. Like, the Gamecocks played their brand of basketball. I mean, I know that they probably maybe, you know, settled for a couple of shots here and there that they probably shouldn't have. That's no really different from any other game. But the difference is that they didn't hit some of those shots, and you just were not going to be able to win this game unless you did that. Here's the number that backs that up. 8 of 29, okay, from long range, right? 8 of 29 puts you at 27.6%. Had they hit two of, I'd say, the five or six wide open threes that they had, two more, they would have been 10 for 29, which would have given them six more points. Now, Tennessee scored 66, but that's because they had to hit some free throws at the end because of fouls. That would have put them at that 34% number that Derek Scott gave us yesterday, by the way.
Yeah.
In this game, I'm not saying they would have won it, but I'm saying they probably very much could have won it. It would have at least been tied with, or maybe the Gamecocks would have had the lead there at the end of the game. So they just didn't hit a couple shots. That's really what it came down to.
Yeah, when you look at it, some of those open looks, just, you know, you go back and it burns you. But I mean, there's still, what a season, you know, all in all. I mean, there's still another game in regular season to play. But, I mean, we never figured in November that this is what we'd be talking about in March.
No.
And to have all the stakes on the line at home against the number four team in the country is just, you know, like I said yesterday, we find ourselves in an improbable place. Mm-hmm. So congrats to the team. Just, you know, it's that magic number all year has been 70 for this team, and that would have done it last night. Defense was still incredible, holding Tennessee to less than that, less than their season average. So, I mean, you come away, just wasn't your night when it comes to the shots. I mean, they just, sometimes the buckets just don't go. And, yep, you know, and it's as simple as that, you know, just, you hate to see it, but I mean, that's the way it is. You still got a big one in Starkville, 'cause you're still playing for all kinds of stuff. You're playing for a double bye, you know, in Nashville. You're playing to maintain a seed higher than, you know, five or six, still well within reach. You know, and then hats off to Tennessee, because, you know, like I said yesterday, if they win everything and they win out in this tournament, they're going to be on the one line, because this is a team who is on a straight heater right now. And you're not going to, I don't think you can deny them one of the top four overall seeds heading into the NCAA tournament.
I don't think so either. I'm with you. I don't even know, Phil. I'm not even so sure that they're going to have to win the SEC tournament to get a one seed. I don't think they can go one and done. I'm with you there. I think that they have to beat Kentucky and then probably win a game. in the SEC.
Yeah, they're probably two wins away.
That's some bad news too, man.
Oh, bad
news. I mean, as long as Arizona doesn't, you know, get on a heater themselves, because they're on the one line now. Yeah. But if those two do, and you compare resumes, it's hard to keep Tennessee off that. I'm with you there.
Yeah, I think so, especially late here for what they've had to go through at the back end of their, you know, say the like last 5-6 games of their regular season and then into the conference championship tournament. So, you know, I don't see how you hold them out. And I mean, and they're a hell of a team. I mean, they really are. It's just, I mean, they came in there and handled their business on the road in a hostile environment, and, you know, hats off.
No question.
Yeah, I think you covered it, but my bad news, JB, already. So if Kentucky does win and they force a four-way tie, Carolina wins, and they force a four-way tie for second, Gamecocks finish fifth. And you're just like, well, how does that happen? Because they beat Kentucky. Kentucky's the Alabama, Auburn, Carolina, Kentucky would all be tied. And Kentucky's 2-1 because they've beaten Bama and Auburn.
Right, right. Yeah. That's what I was saying.
So, yeah, you got to pull for Tennessee.
You're pulling for Tennessee to win. You know, there is no scenario that works unless Kentucky gets beat this weekend.
Yeah.
Like they've got to lose the game, and I think they will. I mean, Tennessee, like you just said, Phil. Like if Tennessee right now was, what are they, 24-6? So if they were at 27-3 and it was all sewed up, you would probably see them doing some things to just kind of keep them, you know, in the flow. But they're playing for a one seed in the turn. Now, is that important to Rick Barnes? I don't know. I mean, is being a one seed really that big of a deal anymore? No, it's not.
But depends on where they put them. You put them in Indianapolis or Charlotte. Memphis. I mean, is there too? So yeah,
they can't control that though. So like, I mean, you know, if you're playing a one versus being a two, is it that big of a deal? Because the Final Four is not four ones every year. I think the last time that happened? Like 2008 or something?
Right. Yeah.
Well, yeah. I mean, but you get like, okay, sevens are a lot more dangerous than eights and nines, and 16s are a lot less deadly than 15s. Although we've had some 16s win. I do think, and sometimes you get that team, the 16 that won the game in Dayton, and they're tired and they come in. So it's not a free pass to be a one. I do think though, and you know, we'll see, we're talking about a sport that bases things on last year and history. So who knows? But, I do think that if you're Tennessee and they try to keep the ones as close to home as possible, unless you have an outlier like Duke, North Carolina, are both a one. One's usually getting sent out west. But, you know, you look at the first round matchups, Indianapolis is a, you know, not a very far drive from Knoxville at all. I've driven that stretch. You know, Memphis is in state. It's far, but it's in state. Charlotte's right there. So, you know, if you want the kind of that home court type of deal, then, you know, you are shooting for the one because your chances of getting put at a place that's favorable to you, unless there's another one in the conference, like I said, you're probably looking pretty good. You know, they would rather take an ice pick and jam it into their ear collectively than not send North Carolina or Duke to Charlotte. You know, and I think UNC and Duke are right on the two line. So if you put a one there with Tennessee, that obviously makes a lot of sense. You know, and that's not a, you know, they travel pretty well for the, I mean, you know, it's just right down 40 and then down 77 to get to Charlotte. So we'll see. And the referee, I know they got some calls to go their way. The refs weren't calling much of anything. And then all of a sudden it's like, we got to play catch up. So we're going to start calling everything. And so that's,
where they swallowed the whistle until they didn't need to.
And Chris, yeah, absolutely. Everybody out there, let's just announce this. South Carolina is going to the NCAA tournament. There is no scenario where they're not going. You know, I'd like for them to avoid an 8 or 7 or 8, and I think they will. I think they, I honest to God, if it weren't for the stupid net, I honest to God think that their resume reads more like a 4 or 5. And that's what we should be talking about right now. But instead, we're going to base crap on history, okay, and metrics, and, oh, did you play pretty or not? Oh, I'm sorry, is this a beauty contest or basketball? You know, this metrics say I don't give a flip anyway. So they're looking at a 6 and maybe drop to a 7, which would be atrocious. I mean, let's say they do lose the next two. You're talking about a 24-8 team that won 12 games in the toughest conference, finished in the top 5 at least, toughest conference in America, one game out of first, and they're a 6 seed?
Well, yeah, I mean, and they're still like, so that, you know, at this point in time, I'm not so sure the Nets really going to matter much. They didn't move last night, and they're not going to move if they get beat in Starkville. But I mean, the as of yesterday, Lenardi actually had them. I know his bracketology showed it on the 6. He actually
made him had on the them 5.
Move to the 5. Yeah, and with that loss last night. Like it's not like they walked in there and got beat by 30 points. You know, I mean, they missed a couple of shots and got beat to by a number one seed. So, if anything, they might have slipped to a 6, but you can climb back up with another Q1 win on Saturday. I mean, you've got two Q1 games coming up, and if you win one of those, you're on the 5 or 6 line. I at the very worst, you're on the 7. But I mean, it's not, and if you win more than that, guess what? That means that you won at least a game in the SEC tournament. So then you're going to have another Q1 win. So I don't see it. Like, it's just kind of settled now, probably, unless you go all the way to the finals of this thing, probably in a 5 to 6, maybe 7 spot.
People are like, I'd rather 6 before a 5 or 4. I know 5s are upset prone, but it's really that second round matchup I'm looking at. You know, and look, there are some threes that are, you know, charlatans, their faults. You know, there's some threes that aren't very good out there through the years we've seen it. And but that 11, you know, what kind of concerned me about the 6-11 is, you know, and Gonzaga's played their way into like an 8 or 7 now. But you had Gonzaga Providence playing in Dayton in the winter play in South Carolina. That's a tough matchup for the Gamecocks against programs that have been there before, and maybe they're trying to fight their way in. And we all saw what Gonzaga could do when they beat Kentucky. You know, Providence obviously has really good players. So that you kind of want to avoid that, because there are a lot of 11 seeds that end up getting that first game. So, you know, 6 makes me uncomfortable. But, look, that's something we could argue about all day, like barbecue sauce, color of uniforms, Nike versus Adidas or Under Armour or Jumpman. Take your Gamecock debate. Is 2001 or Sandstorm better? You know, what's your favorite helmet? You know, seeding in the NCAA tournament. It's like they're all going to be tough. They're all going to be challenging. And, you know, the Gamecocks I think with their style of play, you know, hopefully the matchup's there. You know, you don't want to play Virginia. And that's another 6-11 game I saw projected. You don't want to play Virginia. You play right into their hands. That's how you play. You know, you want to play a team that gets really frustrated because they're trying to go 90 miles an hour and you're just passing it around looking like the Harlem Globetrotters.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah,
put us in the tempo bracket.
Yeah, you know. I mean, yeah. Well, I mean, they certainly slowed Tennessee down again last night, even though Connect, I think, has a combined 60 points versus the Gamecocks in 2 games. But nonetheless, it was a loss, and Carolina's going to have to rebound again. Here's what matters, and you said it, JC. I said it at the top, and you said it. Guys, you don't have to wear orange on Saturday, but you sure do need to pull for them. They have got to beat Kentucky up in Knoxville, and again, I think they will. We do need to step aside for a timeout. When we return, we'll continue having this conversation and also kind of bring some other games into the equation. We should get a new bracketology a little bit later on today. A reminder, a pretty big announcement coming up at 2 o'clock for the future of South Carolina athletics, I guess. And that'll pretty much be right when we're going off the air. JC will probably have to dip a little early to go deal with some of that, but it's going to be something that I think everybody will be pretty darn excited about. So hang tight for that. Pat Bradley ahead at 1, Brad Muller ahead at noon. It's going to be a big fun day here on Inside the Gamecocks, the show.
The State Farm Personal Price Plan helps you create an affordable price just for you.
Contact local agent Gary Patterson for your personal price plan today.
A screen and it goes to Brewer. 20, 15, 10, 5, touchdown Brewer, his second of the day. Pitches it to Brewer, turns the corner, touchdown number 3 of the afternoon.
Hey, folks, it's Mike Morgan for Ryan Brewer Fence. That's right. You know the former Gamecock legend as a terrific college football player. Well, I know him as that, too. I also know him as the guy that runs a great business, one of the best businesses in South Carolina. How do I know that? Well, for one, I'm actually a client of Ryan's. I had my home in Columbia done years ago, and his crew did an outstanding job, just as he does for everybody else. Whether you're in the market for a fence, railings, columns, or anything in between, their craftsmanship, their experience, and service second to none. Ryan Brewer Fence has over 15 years of experience with consultation and installation of residential and commercial fencing and railings. Rest assured, your job will be done with an unparalleled level of expertise, and it's done on time, and they do it right the first time. Again, you're not going to do any better than Ryan Brewer. Ryan Brewer Fence. The website is ryanbrewer.net. Set up an appointment today. Tell them Mike sent you.
My company is Billy G's Carolina Barbecue. We are based in Columbia, South Carolina. And we have two lines of sauces and a spice rub. I mean, when people try our product, they know it's a gourmet product and it can go on any type of food. It's not surprisingly delicious. It's expectedly delicious.
Oh, man. The building is on fire.
Emergencies and accidents happen. When you're in the middle of a fire or water event, all you want is for things to return to normal as soon as possible. Resto Pros of the Midlands is with you, guiding you through the process and working with you to get your home or office back in working order. They'll answer your questions, discuss procedures, and can act as your advocate when it comes to processing your insurance claim. RestoProsMidlandsSC.com. Open 24/7 when you need them. Quality that is guaranteed.
The State Farm Personal Price Plan helps you create an affordable price just for you.
Contact local agent Gary Patterson for your personal price plan today.
They got plenty of that still. There's no doubt. You can see the emotion last night after the ball game. Michi Johnson, for one, was frustrated visibly, but Carolina with a lot to play for, and they are going to be playing in March in the postseason, as we all know. But Mississippi State is coming up next. It's a 2:30 tip time on Saturday in Starkville, 2:30 Eastern, of course. I think Kevin Fitzgerald and Damian Fishback will call it on the SEC network. So, you know, kind of circling back a little bit to the game last night, I was pretty impressed with how South Carolina was defended, and Tennessee, and you could tell that Tennessee was like, you know, we'll give this if we get mismatched or we get out of, you know, somebody loses a guy, it's okay, make them earn it from beyond the 3-point line. And Michi and Zach Davis were a combined 1 of 12 out there. Again, as I pointed out, 3 of 12 would have probably done the trick. With that said, I know there's been some conversation about the non-call on Talon Cooper at the end. That wasn't a foul.
I didn't think so either. I thought he tried to force the issue.
Yeah,
looked like he was trying to kick his legs out or something like that. Now, there were a couple of times where Michi was driving to the hole and in the paint where he would end up on his butt and no whistle. And no, I'm like, yeah, I don't get that. But I mean, you know, that's not why he lost this game. I mean, period. You can't blame it on officiating. You had the opportunities in the first half to be up by 12 at the half and not down by 14 or whatever it was. Just by nailing some of those open looks. Even still, I mean, here we are. Colin Murray Boyles in this loss still puts up a double-double.
Yeah.
Three blocks. Yeah, you know, I mean, and he's playing bigger than he is. Yeah. And one thing I think too, JB, taking away from what happened last night is these look like two teams who had played each other before.
Sure.
Like they knew, you know, everybody had their recipe and had a feel for themselves. Carolina just went back in there with what, you know, got the job done last time. And you could tell that Tennessee, like you said, adjusted to that and was going to say, hey, if you can make it rain threes, and they just weren't falling, you know? So, yeah. I mean, it's, you know, it's just what it is. And it would be great to see them match up for a third time on a neutral court and see what that looks like, because that I think would be a hell of a game.
it very well could. Yeah. I mean, the physicality in this game, and there were certainly some non-calls, I think at one point in time. And again, I listened to Derek and I kind of go back and forth, but at some point in time, Jimmy did mention, well, this really is a rock fight. I mean, they were getting banged up pretty good. And Miles Studi ran into some screens that I thought at some point in time, you know, if you can get there early enough before they get set and get called, you know, get one called as a moving screen and get him back to the other end of the floor, he thrives in that. So I kind of thought maybe, in addition to the fact that he did hit a pair of threes, I mean, he was 2 of 3 from long range. He looked good out there shooting it. But I thought maybe that would be a turning point in the game if they could get to it, but they just couldn't. But he got banged around pretty good. Kinect got banged around pretty good and got around everything. And, you know, when they would switch and Studio would get lost on Kinect, that's a mismatch, especially with that knee brace on. There's just nothing he can do about it. You know, I mean, one step gives Kinect 4 steps. And he's so good, that high shot, there was just nothing they could do. I'm not so sure what else they could do. So it was a really tough physical game. It was a good game in the sense that it was, you know, close and had some drama. I'm not so sure that you would call it the cleanest good game on the planet by any stretch of the imagination. I was a little disappointed, if I'd say anything, in my very limited basketball knowledge. Well, I've got more than you think, but you know what I'm saying here. I'm not an expert. I was a little bit disappointed that earlier they didn't attempt to get into the paint a little bit more, and not necessarily just dumping it down to Mac or you know, Colin Murray Boyles or Studi when he was in there, or Josh Gray. I don't really mean it like that, but just trying to kind of drive and get in there and draw some fouls and string this thing out a little bit and maybe get to the free throw line a little bit more. But, you know, again, you had wide open shots and you missed them. So, I mean, you got to hit those. Like, you can argue all these other reasons for losing the game. This magnitude of a basketball game, this time of the year, when you play for championships, you have got to hit shots. In baseball, you play for championships, you got to pitch, and you got to hit. And you got to play clean defense. You know, and South Carolina played pretty clean defense for the most part. You know, outside of the best player in the country getting free a couple of times. And, you know, they did some other things well, but they didn't hit open shots. And you've got to hit open shots to win championships. So it happened the way that it probably should have happened last night, unfortunately. But what you can tell how much respect Tennessee's got for the Gamecocks. It starts with Rick Barnes. I mean, he look at what those guys have done, Phil. This year, 24-6. They had the rough stretch early when they got beat by Purdue, Kansas, and North Carolina. And then they had some bugaboos here and there on the road against A&M and Mississippi State. That's it. The only other loss they had was at home against South Carolina, their only home loss of the year. And you look at all the other big games that they've played in this league against teams that are headed to the dance, they beat Florida by 19. They beat Alabama by 20. They beat Kentucky in Lexington by 11. They beat Auburn by 8 at home. They went to Tuscaloosa, Alabama, and beat them by 7. And all those are scoring 80 and 90 and 100 points a game. And here they are averaging 64 against the Gamecocks and lost to them once. I mean, I think it's pretty clear who he has the most respect for outside of his own club in this league. And I know Lamont Paris appreciates him saying that.
Yeah, I mean, well-deserved, too. Coach Paris, I think, is maybe a couple of weeks ago, firmly cemented himself as SEC Coach of the Year. And, you know, I would be surprised if he was not top of the list on National Coach of the Year. I mean, what he has done in 2 years here at South Carolina is just nothing short of magic. I mean, it really is. He has put together team that has played beyond the year's experience playing with each other, and it's just been interesting to see like his concept come to life this year. I mean, he said it all year long. You go out and you get the right guys. Mm-hmm. And not only did he get the right kind of guys, but on the coaching end of things, he has gotten them to buy in to what it is he's trying to do. And that just 100% and complete and total buy-in is exactly what has gotten them this far as they've gotten. Yeah. I mean, so it's like, even though yesterday stung, you can't take away from the fact the whole body of work this year has just been overperforming expectations outside of the locker room, but nothing but proof of concept for what Coach Paris has been trying to put together and what he knew could happen when he stood on that podium and took it personally when they picked him last in the SEC.
Yeah, it's a great point. It really is a great point. Kevin makes a good point here too. Zach Davis didn't attempt a shot inside the arc. He says, I hope that they get him back to attacking the rim and staying aggressive. And to your point, to back that up a little bit there too, from Kevin, in those two road victories at Ole Miss and at Texas A&M, he was 12 of 23 from the floor, was Zach Davis, but a combined 0 for 5 from outside, and he scored 30 points. So he was able to get in, get to the rim. That game at Ole Miss, he was 6 of 8 from the free throw line. And then against the Gators, he only fired up 4 shots. Half of those, you know, were from beyond three-point land, or out in three-point land. But he was 6 of 6 from the free throw line, and he contributed there as part of his 8-point performance. I think that's a really good observation. You can see Coach Paris coaching him on the sidelines with some things he probably could do a little bit different. He's not going to stop shooting threes. Like he's generally probably going to shoot somewhere between 2 and 4 threes a game. That's just he is. They're not going to stop him from doing that. They're going to let him shoot. And they have power over that, and we can prove that because Colin Murray Boyles was told to not shoot three-pointers, and he doesn't.
And so, he doesn't.
Yeah, you know, so Zach Davis is actually encouraged by this staff. Like they know he can knock him down, and so they do encourage him to shoot out there. And I don't think you want him out there firing up, you know, 5, 6, 7, 10 of them from long range per game if he's going to hit 10-20% of them. That's probably not ideal, and I understand that. But again, yeah, you know, this type of game, Michi was 0 for 7 from long range. Like Michi's got to hit a couple of those, and had he done it, they hit that 34% clip that Derek talked about yesterday, and they either win the game, or it's like a nail biter at the end with a chance to win the game. So, yeah. You know, they are who they are, and it's worked thus far. They got beat last night by a team who's absolutely on a heater and has deserved to win the Southeastern Conference championship there. On that note, and I guess make sure that I was not told to say anything about this. Okay, so it looks like we are going to be scheduled to have Lamont Paris with us Monday or Tuesday of next week, which will be obviously after the conclusion of the regular season and headed to Nashville for the SEC tournament. So it looks like that. I just got that email a little bit ago. So we should have the head ball coach of hoops here in early next week. So that'll be good. Good timing. We can question his decision making at that point in time, face to face, mano a mano, Phil.
Yeah, that's right. That's right. Yeah. We'll watch the chat box fall silent like it always does.
That's right.
People who come on the show.
That son of a, he ain't worth the damn. Well, here he is. Oh man, I gotta go to the bathroom. Oh yeah,
the Coach Paris is probably one of the only ones this year that everybody's just like, yeah, he's the man, you know, because yeah, he is the man.
That's right. And Quantrell, he's on it, man. Next year, I would anticipate. I hate even talking about next year. I don't want to talk about it really because they've still got so much to play for. But like, there's. As long as nothing crazy happens in the offseason, and I would say that there's always a chance, but I think you should probably feel pretty good about this group at this point in time. You know, Michi is going to go through the process, right? And then most likely, Michi Johnson should be returning to South Carolina unless he just gets a bunch of money he cannot turn down somewhere, whether it's G League or overseas or something. And that could happen. That could happen. And kids got game. But if he returns, and he probably at that point in time would return as one of the top, if not the top, guard in the league, this will be Colin Murray Boyles and Zach Davis's team. And you know dang well in the postseason what they're going to be working on those two guys with. And that is that shot from outside, because Murray Boyles, prior to getting mono, was draining them from downtown. And Lamont told the story a couple of weeks ago about the fact that he said, yeah, forget it. Get in the paint, and here's what you're doing. We'll worry about that crap another time so we can get this sucker clicking, and that's right. And to your point, I think Quantrell nailed it. I mean, Zach Davis, there's nothing to not love about this kid's game. I love watching him play basketball. If he can start hitting from out there, he's in that 30-35% from long range. Woo! He will be. I mean, he'll be BJ Mack, just not as big as, not as thick as BJ Mack, being able to step out and do those things. So it'll be interesting to keep an eye on that. Elsewhere last night, I want to squeeze this in too. Houston was scared in Orlando, but they unscared themselves and survived in a very similar fashion, 67-59, the final down there. So Houston will continue to rock and roll on the one line. UConn Marquette. Top eight game, the Huskies went to eighth-ranked Marquette and got through that with a 7-point victory, improving to 27-3 overall. Sixth-ranked Iowa State knocked off 20th-ranked BYU. That followed the Gamecocks and Vols on ESPN2. Iowa State having a really good year, 24-6, 13-4 in the Big 12. And then also in the SEC, Kentucky and Vanderbilt. That game was really interesting in the first half. But I mean, you felt like, look, Kentucky's going to score, so Vanderbilt needs to score. But like, Vanderbilt also at some point in time is going to probably need to find a way to stop Kentucky from scoring if they want a chance to pull off the most improbable of improbables. And they just couldn't do that. Kentucky hit a three at the buzzer at halftime to give them the 5-point lead, and they ended up hanging 93 on the doors. 93-77. A&M over Mississippi State. That's a stinger for the Dogs. I think they're still okay. JC mentioned that yesterday. I agree with him, but they're going to be out for blood when the Gamecocks come walking through the door on Saturday in the hump, because they don't want to finish 19-12, 8-10 in the SEC's regular season before they head to Nashville, because that would require them to win three games there just to get back to 500. And then Mike called this one last night, Arkansas over LSU in Fayetteville, 94-83. I think, who did we have on the show yesterday?
We had Clark Cox.
Clark about. And Derek? Derek.
And Derek.
Was it Derek that mentioned how many 90-plus point games have been in the SEC this year? It was, wasn't it?
I think it was either that or it was Mike on –
might have been Mike. I don't
driver know. In the SEC, but yeah, there's been a ton of points scored in this league this year.
Yeah, I mean, I've never seen the SEC score as many points as they've scored. I mean, everybody can score, seemingly, except for a couple of teams, but somehow South Carolina, outside of the one game on the Plains, holds them to somewhere in the 60s. I mean, it's incredible. It's again, you just hit a couple shots, and well, would you look at that? There they are with 24 wins on the season. So, you know, we'll move forward, and the next one is coming up this weekend in the Magnolia State. A bunch of games today. If you're a fan of postseason basketball, the Sun Belt second round is ongoing. The MVC, that's the first round, I think. Yeah, that's the first round. First game, Missouri State and Murray State playing today. The Sun Belt, I mentioned, is in the second round. The West Coast Conference, they are in the first round today starting their tournament. The Patriot League is in the quarterfinals of their basketball tournament. The Horizon League is in the quarterfinals of their tournament as well. The A-Sun Semis, those will play today as well. So lots of men's hoops in postseason tournaments already. And then, of course, the ladies are on the floor as well. And Brad Muller's coming up here in about 7 minutes. Gamecocks won't play till tomorrow, but the ACC is already underway this afternoon. The Pac-12 tournament is being played, the SEC, and so on and so forth. So it is tournament season on both sides, men and women. For what it's worth, at 2:30 on the SEC Network, Kentucky will take on the Tennessee Volunteers in Greenville. And there's been a bunch of uproar and rumors spreading through Knoxville that Kelly Harper might not make it. So it might do her some good to try to do some damage in the SEC tournament and get into the postseason if she wants to survive as the head coach of the Lady Vols. But that is certainly a major storyline in women's college basketball if Tennessee makes a change there.
Excuse me. Yes.
Yeah, I wonder who's going to want that job. I mean,
yeah. You don't say, huh?
Yes.
Carol Lawson, that sound familiar? You think that'll be it? Would there even be another candidate than Carol Lawson? I can't imagine they'd consider anybody else, would they?
Probably not.
Probably not, yeah. You mean she'd at least have first right of refusal.
Is that a thing?
I don't know. Remember, right of first refusal. I don't.
First right of, yeah, I don't think that's how it works, is it? Yeah, first.
I don't know. I mean, you can say no. I mean, you can change your mind in a heartbeat. You could, you know, sign a contract to be a coach on a team for a year, and then 2 to 3 weeks later, just say, "I don't want to do this now," and walk away and go somewhere else. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Strange times.
Strange times for sure. It's 11:55. Again, at 1, Pat Bradley will join us from the SEC Network. We've had him on before. We're going to have him on again. He'll look back on the game last night and look forward at this weekend and the scenario that could be unfolding in the SEC. It's the top is tight, as we all well know. We talked about this situation earlier and how Carolina could finish technically anywhere still from 2 to 6th. With one game to play. That's pretty wild. So what we'll do, since we did miss a timeout, we'll go ahead and hit one of those. Brad Muller will be joining us next. South Carolina on deck tomorrow. TBD, we can play. But it's a noon trip on Sports Wellness Arena up in the land of one Mad Dog Mullinax. So we'll
up in the up country, dark
in the up country, the up country. Yeah, that's right. Yeah, I love some folks that have moved here from out of state who call the Midlands the mid state and down here the low state. I'm like, well, it's the low country, the Midlands, and the upstate. But I hear you. I hear you, Maryland. You nailed it.
I still like calling it the up country.
That's all right. That's because you're from there.
Yeah, that's true. That's true. Yeah, I mean, upstate, I get that. A lot of these transplants brought that with them ages ago.
JC's just from the Berg.
Berg.
The Berg. The dirty Berg.
The Berg. The dirty Berg.
Dirty Berg.
Nice. That should be on a t-shirt. All right. Hang tight. Brad Muller, voice of Gamecock women's basketball. Up next here on Inside the Gamecocks, the show from the Cinerama Studios.
Gamecock Traditions, South Carolina's elite retailer for anything Gamecock related. The best selection for basketball, baseball, football, tailgating, kids stuff, and everything else. If it's got the Gamecock logo, it's got to be at Gamecock Traditions. Most importantly, they ship it to your doorstep. Order online at GamecockTraditions.com, where there's always a sale. Gamecock Traditions, GamecockTraditions.com, a tradition unlike the others.
South Carolinians, this message is for you, as well as for people in Georgia, Florida, and Tennessee. If you think you may need work done to your roof or a new roof altogether, there's one simple name to remember: Elite Roofing and Restoration. South Carolina native Jeremy Johnson has been helping people in the South make sure they have the very best people checking on and building new roofs for over 25 years. Fully licensed, bonded, and insured, they provide the best service possible. Call or email today, 678-781-1998. That's 678-781-1998, or you can go to EliteRoofingGA.com. Schedule a no-hassle, free inspection today. Wind damage, hail damage, or just wear and tear. Don't settle for second best. Let Jeremy Johnson and Elite Roofing and Restoration take care of it all for you today.
Nana's Porch, nanasporch.com. At Nana's Porch, they cater weddings, parties, and all kinds of special events. Their meals are served buffet style. In seconds, they're encouraged. Plus, they can bring their mobile food unit to bring on-site and serve your guests as a unique alternative for your catering needs. Inquire about rentals as well. Nanasporch.com. Find them on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram. 336-259-7550.
Tony Pope State Farm is your go-to agent anywhere in South Carolina, North Carolina, or Georgia for the service you deserve at the price you want. So try combining your home, life, auto, and or small business insurance today. Tony Pope State Farm has been in business for more than 30 years and can handle anything you need in the tri-state area. 843-851-2222 or visit TonyPope.com today. Like a good neighbor, State Farm is there.
I said, oh, Lord Jesus, it's a fire. Ain't nobody got time for that.
Disaster comes uninformed. During and after natural disasters or accidents, there can be a heavy loss to property. Having your home or office destroyed or damaged by water, fire, smoke, or mold affects your personal and business lifestyle. Resto Pros of the Midlands is here to help. Open 24/7. Call them when you need them. 803-493-0170. Resto Pros of the Midlands. RestoProsMidlandsSC.com. Quality that is guaranteed.
Down here in the South, we don't always see eye to eye. While our taste in college football teams, or what sauce, if any, goes best on a rack of ribs, or what to mix with our Dixie vodka might be up for debate, we can all agree there's nothing better than a Southern tailgate. And like our favorite college teams, our ingredients come from small towns and big cities. They're grown in Southern soil, are crafted by Southern hands, and proudly represent the South in our backyard and beyond. So raise a glass of Dixie Southern Vodka to celebrate being made in America and raised in the South.
Welcome home. That's what the Gamecocks say. And so does the Barn Dough Company, where they can build your dream home starting as low as $160 per square foot. If you live in the Carolinas, Georgia, or Tennessee, their turnkey process takes just 4 to 6 months on average and can be custom designed by size and details. Make your dream a reality. Visit thebarndominiumco.com. That's thebarndominiumco.com. The Barn Dough Company, Gamecock, owned and operated. Attention baseball and softball players. For virtual hitting lessons and evaluations, contact former baseball record holder and All-American Michael Campbell at 859-414-8240 or email soupsswingshop@gmail.com. Go Gamecocks!
Billy G's Carolina Barbecue presents the national anthem at noon every day here on Inside the Gamecocks. The show, Billy G's Carolina Barbecue, can be found. Let me give my best Derek Scott here. Deep, a high drive down the right field line in foul territory. That's where you'll find the food truck, and it will serve you well. Because if you haven't had the Big Tex or the Big Porker or the Mac Attack, you're missing out. Gamecock Baseball and Barbecue at Founders Park this season. The official barbecue of our programming and of Carolina Baseball. This is the official voice of Gamecock Women's Basketball, who's set to take the floor tomorrow at the SEC Tournament up in Bon Secours Wellness Arena in Greenville. They'll await the winner of 9th-seeded Texas A&M and 8th-seeded Mississippi State, and that sucker is tipping off literally as we speak. It will be followed by 12th-seeded Kentucky, who took down Georgia yesterday, and they've got the 5th-seeded Vols. We mentioned what's on the line for Kelly Harper. But, Brad, you probably never even thought about this, the humble Brad Muller. What is your record as the voice of Gamecock women's basketball?
Oh, wow. Gosh, it's been pretty good lately. But
getting lost this year.
Yeah. Last year was pretty good. The year before was pretty good. I don't know. I have to go back. I've been here 17 years. So I got here the year before Coach Daly did. It wasn't good to start, but it's gotten a lot better, especially the last 10 years.
Yeah, it's you're right. Do you see? We always tell Derek, all right, you know the drill, Derek. Go get us a win, and when he doesn't, you know. But we don't have to worry about that with you because they win everything. Hey, with the national championships, did you get a ring with that?
I did. I've gotten one for every national championship, every SEC championship. Coach Daly and her staff have been very kind in sharing the love. I've got a shelf full of them. You know, I never bring them with me because they're like Super Bowl rings, and you can't type on a keyboard or do anything with them. You can't get their security with them. That's for sure.
Dude, that is awesome.
Yeah, it's pretty cool.
Do you have one that you like more than the others, like the design
not really. They're all pretty cool. They're all unique. They're huge. Sometimes the first one is always the coolest because it was the first one. It's just neat. I mean, I'm very grateful, and it's not something I expect, but it's just really nice to get as someone who has followed this program the last 17 years. So it's pretty neat. I consider myself lucky to have them because you never know when it's going to happen again.
Yeah. Well, that's really neat. That is really, really cool. So hats off to Don for making sure that's taken care of too. All right. So I'm assuming that they drove up there this morning on the bus, cause I know they stayed for the game last night, right? Were you on the bus with them?
No, actually, the team drove up last night. I drove up this morning so I could take my son to school. Yeah, but I got here about 9:30 this morning and just came straight to the gym. That's where I am now, and apologize if the Wi-Fi has actually been a little bit spotty here, so they need to work on that a little bit. Oh. But they came up last night after the men's game, and they had a little shoot-around practice here about an hour ago before this first game of the tournament today started, and they're here watching this game right now because this is obviously they'll get the winner of this game tomorrow at noon.
Mm-hmm. They're going for their eighth tournament title in 10 years. How does Coach Staley approach this every year? I'm always curious if there's.
Well, she takes it seriously, unlike, sometimes, if you want to compare it to, let's say, SEC baseball, there's a lot of teams that go to the baseball tournament, and they're happy to go two and out or whatever it is just because they don't want to use up their pitching and save their arms and all that. But if there's a chance to bring home a trophy and cut down a net, it doesn't matter if it's, a tournament in November, somewhere else or whatever, she wants to be the last one standing. So, yeah, this is the next game. This is the next opportunity to do something special. And, I think she always takes it seriously because for maybe half of her team, this is their first tournament. So while it's not new to her and maybe a couple of the other kids that have been around, it's always special because they haven't done it before. And for the ones that did do it before, maybe they weren't key contributors, especially with this team. I mean, the Gamecocks replaced all 5 starters from last year. And the kids that did hold over from last year were ones that came off the bench and didn't play a whole lot. So this is their first chance to to be the stars and things like that, and to, you know, have their name put up there next to, you know, the likes of the Aaliyah Bostons and the Asia Wilsons and all that.
And seemingly another home game for them, or all of the games are home games because they're bound to play multiple inside of that arena each year. So now that we're 29 games in, 29-0, they stand 29-0 today. How would you describe this team, this group here, versus maybe how you would have described them to start the season?
They're certainly, well, they've always been confident. It's hard because myself, like everyone else, wanted to compare this team to the previous 4 years where it was the same crew, and this is just a different crew. This team is a lot more the previous year's team was a lot more businesslike. This team is a lot more 20-year-old young ladies. They have fun. I mean, they're loud. They have a good time. It's not a knock on either team, you know, this one or the last or the, you know, the previous group. They're just different in personality. This one is, they're just exuberant and, it's just a totally different group. You know, the other team was mature beyond their years from day one. This team at times, scratch your head a little bit, but that's okay. You know, it's just different, but they're talented. They're fun to be around. They enjoy each other. That's the important thing. And they're unselfish because, you know, you've got kids coming off the bench here that could start almost anywhere else in the country, but they still want to be here. You know, and that's hard to do in this day and age when, you know, kids, if they're not starting, want to hit the portal. And you had Ashlyn Watkins this year, who one of her goals was to be the sixth woman of the year. Now, she didn't get that. She still got second team all SEC. But, you know, that's kind of unusual that she was fine coming off the bench because she wanted to, you know, she knew what her role is, and she was playing as many minutes, if not more, than some of the starters there anyway. So it's just a fun group to be around because it's different. And I don't think anybody expected them to do what they did this year because of who we lost last year. And so, you know, I think, you know, Coach Staley was the SEC coach of the year for the seventh time. And I think it's incredible what she did. I've never heard of a team that lost all five starters from a year ago and they go undefeated, you know, so it's after going undefeated the year before. So it's just been pretty remarkable how far ahead of schedule they were, back in November.
Brad Muller, voice of the Gamecocks. I think that's a great point, and I think it gets lost a lot because there's probably a lot of people who vote, and then a lot of people, you know, fans, people like us who just kind of onlookers who assume that Dawn Staley, well, they went 29-0, they're the best team in the league. Give it to her because, you know, they're 29-0 and the best team in the league. And maybe some who voted on it looked at it that way too. But in the context and what you described, they replaced five starters. Now, they replaced five starters with five very talented starters. Yeah. I mean, yeah. It's not like South Carolina's at the end of the year going, well, what are we going to do next year? And they have McDonald's All-Americans every year. That's what she's built. But, Brad, you've been doing this long enough to know it's not easy to replace a couple of starters, let alone five, and have everything flow and not have one game. Where that slip up or two reflects it on the scoreboard with an L. They've had their moments, but they certainly figure out how to kick it into gear. I think it's a killer point that you make.
Yeah, and it's interesting because, you know, you lose generational players like you had last year, like an Aaliyah Boston, who was a National Player of the Year and a multiple SEC Player of the Year, and you have other kids step up that, you know, really maybe played five, 10 minutes a game last year. They come into starting roles this year, but you see a lot of the player development. And I think that's the biggest thing about this coaching staff, not just Coach Staley, but her assistants. You see the player development from year to year. A player like Chloe Kitts, who last year came in, you know, graduated high school early and, you know, looked a little lost as a half freshman, if you will, playing the second semester last year, comes in this year and she's a starter most of the year as a freshman and a half, if you will. And then, you know, Ashlyn Watkins, her development has been off the chart. And Breezy Hall, who again was a role player last year as maybe a defender coming off the bench, and she's been a starter all year and has hit some huge shots, including a couple of big threes and the comeback win at LSU back a couple of months ago. So I think the player development is something you can't overlook here with kids that you knew were good coming out of high school, but not every McDonald's All-American pans out. well, they've developed these kids, you know, while they've waited their turn, so to speak. And you know, look what they've done. You've seen that with some of the freshman class this year. Malaysia Fulwiley, you knew was going to be good. But, you know, she's come a long way on the defensive end. And then Tessa Johnson's another freshman who, you know, when she first got here, you thought, okay, maybe you're not going to see much of her this year. But now that kid, not only does she knock down some big shots, but she's playing D on the other end, and she's got a better sense of what the college game is. So, again, I got to give credit to this whole staff for how they are able to develop players over time.
Yeah, and Brett, and certainly, you know, we're going to discuss with you this tournament itself and the future, the rest of the season. But I think that this – I don't want this to come out wrong, so I don't mean it that way. But largely this fan base and most people who pay attention to Dawn Staley's program, they just expect them to win. And you know, it's insert next name, they go. Insert next name, they go. And you get a very, you know, broad brushed view of the program. They're just really talented. And then they go out and play and they beat the bejesus out of whoever they play. And they have some tough games here and there. That's what we see from the outside. But the inside, it's Coach Staley and her staff's job to find a way to get this team to come together and do the things that they're capable of doing with all of that talent. And replacing leadership is a difficult thing in sports. And I think one of the things that I was most impressed by this year, because I guess there's three transfers on the team with Walker. And then, of course, Cardoso has been here now for a couple of years. And then Pow Pow, it's her first season. Mm-hmm. And she stepped right in and became a leader amongst a group of all Americans who they were recruited to play here. And they signed and they came right out of high school. And then you bring in this talented young lady from Oregon. And she just steps right in and kind of absorbs it as her team, it seems like, from the outside looking in. Again, I'm asking you, but what's that process been like? You see it inside and out. What's that been like with her kind of absorbing that role?
You know, it's not easy when you get young people together to have that kind of chemistry right off the bat. And that's something that they had when they brought some new players in. You know, Camilla knew this was going to be her year to step up after being a bench player, you know, a significant player off the bench the previous couple of years. But with Pow Pow, it was huge because of what she's able to bring. But I think, you know, the neat thing about someone like Pow Pow is she's not one of those volume shooters that steps into a program and says, all right, you know, I'm here, I'm going to shoot it 30 times a game and everyone else is going to have to deal with it. You know, she's one of the best three-point shooters in the country. But when you look at her stat sheet, most nights she's not taking more than four or five threes per game. And, you know, she's not putting up more than 10 shots. She's running the offense. And that, to me, that's leadership. You know, she can play the one or the two, but she's not out there, even though she's one of the best shooters in the country, saying, all right, I've got to jack it up 20 times a game to get mine. She has a point guard mentality, fortunately, where she's going to look for, you know, a shot closer to the basket for someone else or drive to the basket herself. But she's not going to sit there and just jack up threes all day. And I think that's a big thing that other players see, that as good as you are, that you're still a team player and you're going to get me the ball if I'm in a better position to shoot it. And I think that's something that really resonates.
And she's coming back next
year. Yeah, thank God.
I mean, holy smokes. Wow. This is incredible. Yeah. Is this, when I say this, I hate asking questions like this, but I think they're fan questions and people like hearing the answers. Offensively, is this the best that we've maybe ever seen this program?
You know, maybe the most balanced in a while because of that ability to hit shots, knock wood, from the outside. Because, you know, the last few years, it was pretty much all inside. And then occasionally, you know, somebody would hit a three or, you know, a perimeter shot. But the previous years, it was really, you know, Aaliyah Boston, Victoria Saxton, and Camilla Cardoso and what have you. But I don't think we've ever had as good a three-point shooting team. At least in the last 10 years or so, we've had some individuals that were okay. They had moments, you know, Tina Roy back in the day, Tiffany Mitchell certainly was fantastic a few years ago, a two-time SEC player of the year. But in terms of multiple players that, you know, can shoot it decently between, you know, Pow Pow and Breezy Hall, and even Raven Johnson at times, she's come a long way since last year as well, where you have to play them honest, and that frees things up inside when you've got obviously those perimeter threats. You can't just double, you know, previous 4 years, everybody double teamed Aaliyah Boston or, you know, or sagged in those zones and just said, we'll take our chances with you guys not hitting a lot from the outside, because they wouldn't. But you know, just having those threats from the outside from multiple places Tessa Johnson coming off the bench as well. It frees things up so they can't double team. We don't see nearly as much zone this year as we did in previous years. And I think that's helped open up the offense. You know, the 2017 national championship team was pretty remarkable. The remarkable thing about that team is, you know, they played that high-low offense with Asia Wilson and Elena Coates, but you still had some really good guards, you know, with Kayla Davis. You had Ty Harris as a freshman. You know, you had Alicia Gray as well. You had a lot of threats. And then, you know, crazy thing was right before the NCAA tournament started in 17, you lose Elena Coates, your All-American center. You insert another guard instead of a big and Bianca Cuevas, and they actually played better and won the NCAA tournament. And, you know, if you would have told me you're going to lose your All-American center and play better, you know, I would have called you a liar, but that's how it turned out. But yeah, to answer the original question, yeah, these are probably the most threats we've had from the outside in terms of having multiple people who can, you know, hit down from 15 feet or further.
Brad Muller, voice of the Gamecocks. They will tip tomorrow at noon, and you can watch it, but as we encourage you to do with Derek and Casey all the time, make sure you've got it. Brad's voice in the background on the Gamecock Sports Network as well. So I'm not so sure how much information you can give us on this one. It's a little bit different, but these two programs together, the men and the women, I mean, this is an incredible story. I mean, they're a combined 53-6. The poor men have all six losses. But I mean, you know, they're seemingly, or at least the men have seemed to feed a little bit off of the support of the women's program. And I think it seems like it's been important to see Dawn Staley so visible in supporting Lamont Paris and his team on national television and all those type things. What have you learned about the relationship? I know a couple, you know, one young lady is dating one young man from the other team. I know that's become a popular point, but what have you learned about the relationship of Lamont's guys and Dawn's ladies and how they've kind of come together to continue to push each other to do some pretty special things here?
Well, it's neat because everybody wants, you know, all the programs to succeed, because when another program is succeeding, that helps your program as well. That helps in recruiting. You know, when you bring a kid on a campus visit or something like that, and there's a buzz about, you know, one of your other sports as well, that helps because it's an experience. So you know, that's something Coach Staley has done throughout her career here, is she's been close to a lot of the programs, whether it was men's basketball, even when Frank was here. She's been very close, obviously, with the softball program. She and Bev Smith are a good coach. She's, you know, it's not uncommon to see coach at softball games, soccer games, all that, because one, she's friends with the other coaches, but it's important for the other teams to do well. That helps your program. It helps in recruiting, but it is neat with Lamont as well, because it's hard not to like a guy like Lamont Paris. It's kind of like Shane Beamer. It's hard not to like him if you've ever met him, because of how they treat people and their public persona. You know, it's hard not to like them. You want to see them succeed. And to have the success that Lamont is having in year two is just, it's ridiculous. I mean, nobody saw this coming. And, you know, it's great that, you know, Dawn is there and the team is there to help celebrate with them and be there. If that draws more attention to the men's program, but hey, there, you know, every time Dawn's at a game, you see it on the TV, there's Dawn Staley. Okay, that's pub for her program, but that's also pub for the men's program of, you know, showing recruits that, you know, that celebrities, if you will, are vested in this program. You know, Coach Beamer's at a lot of the games and all that. Yeah. And that's meaningful. I think it all helps in recruiting. But again, it's genuine, that it's not something like where, you know, Dawn's the big dog, if you want to say, on the, you know, has been the big dog around here so long that she's like, no, you know, I want to be the only one that succeeds. No, she wants to see all these teams, you know, get trophies and win championships. And that's the way it should be.
Brad, as it pertains to this, the 2024 version of the SEC Women's Basketball Tournament, again, A&M and Mississippi State are on the floor and underway. The winner of this ball game will get the top-seeded and top-ranked Gamecocks tomorrow. A&M, for what it's worth, at the end of the first quarter, is up 14-9 on the Bulldogs. Outside of the expectation, which is that South Carolina will just run their way right into another SEC title, how would you describe the league overall this year and what that could mean for what we're seeing here in the conference tournament?
Yeah, I think it's a little top heavy. You have South Carolina and LSU, who are obviously the cream of the crop this year. And, you know, LSU, even though South Carolina won in Baton Rouge this year and it took everything they could, you're rallying from an 11-point deficit in that game. LSU has as much talent on paper to repeat, not only to win here at the SEC tournament, but they have enough talent to win the whole thing again. They basically assembled an all-star team. So don't count them out, even though they've had some moments this year where they've had some head-scratching losses that, you know, when it comes tournament time, LSU is just as good as any of the top teams out there and can certainly get back to the Final Four. But the rest of the league, I think, by its own standard, which had been pretty good, is down a little bit in terms of, I always look at it as teams that I can picture getting to the Sweet 16. And, you know, there's not as many this year as I always think about in years past. There's some teams that are struggling, that are on the bubble. Mississippi State is one of those teams. They need a win, I think, today to put them back in to the NCAA tournament consideration. You know, there's teams that have kind of underachieved, I think, a little bit. Tennessee has a lot of talent, and they've played a difficult schedule, but they haven't won any of those difficult games. So I think my, again, the usual standard of half the league is really pretty darn good. It's a little bit down. You know, the bottom is not very good this year. And after you get five, you know, teams deep in the SEC, after that, you know, there's not as many teams that make you think, oh, yeah, they could make a run. So I think it was a little bit down by our usual standard. And I think part of that is, you know, the Pac-12 this year was unbelievable. They keep beating each other up. They've got, I think a week ago, they had five teams in the top 11 just in the Pac-12. So that'll be a tournament to watch to see who survives that thing. And, you know, if you're looking ahead at schedules for the NCAA tournament, pay attention where those Pac-12 schools are, because you get a tough matchup in the Sweet 16 or the Elite Eight. Watch out for anybody.
Yeah, well, I'm with you on that, man. I mean, shoot, yeah, the Pac-12 is, wow.
It's a swan song.
Yeah, exactly. Can you believe that? What's happened with the Pac-12? I mean, if you really think about the league overall, like, I'm anxious to see what baseball does, but I mean, look what they did in football, and look what they're doing in basketball, and they're going to be gone.
You know, It's a shame.
Yeah. Hey, but good news. So Stanford's going to be in the ACC. So we're all winners here, Brad.
Yeah. Stanford on the Atlantic coast. That makes sense. Yes. That's
right. Still, Phil calls it the All Coast Conference.
All Coast Conference, right. Yeah.
I think, when did Charlie? It's been a few days. So Charlie Krim had last updated his on the 4th of March, and he had eight SEC teams in there. I was a little surprised by that, Brad. I don't know if you consider yourself a bracketologist or not, yeah. but you know, do you keep an eye on, do you have a number in your head of, well, they'll get this many teams in, but I don't know if they'll get this many.
You know, depending on how things go at the SEC tournament, you know, if somebody makes a run, I would have said before the tournament six. Other people seem to think seven, but I thought, you know, to me, that's a little bit of a stretch. But yeah, eight really would surprise me. But, you know, if they do great, you know, I love to see the league in there, and especially for my, you know, fellow broadcasters to their school, because it's, you know, I want them to be able to get there and have some fun. But again, just looking at the strength of some of the other leagues, I didn't think there would be that many. But if somebody gets on a little bit of a run here, wins a couple of games, that gets them in, you know, such as a Mississippi State, who, you know, really needs a win today, I think, to get in. You know, I think the league most likely will get seven. But you know, I don't know how many of them will get past the first couple of rounds. Hopefully they do. And you know, a lot of it has to do with what happens in the other conference tournaments as well. If you get something crazy where, you know, a five or six seed from a specific conference wins the tournament, their conference tournament title, and gets an automatic bid, that takes one away from somebody else from another league. So see how that shakes out. But, you know, eight seemed to be a bit generous, but if it happens, hey, that's great.
Yeah. I mean, it looks right now, it looks like Tennessee could be safe, but you know, we'll see.
Yeah, I think their strength of schedule and the fact that what hurt them was their best player missed eight games and they went 4-4 without her. That was earlier in the season. So I think the committee would take that into account, their schedule and the fact that their best player was absent for eight games.
Okay. All right. Yeah. Auburn, Vanderbilt, Mississippi State. Again, this is 3 days old, but Auburn, one of the last four byes, Mississippi State, one of the last four in. Vanderbilt one of the last four. And again, according to Charlie Krim, and then the first one out, he actually had A&M, which is interesting because A&M and Mississippi State are playing right now.
Right. Yeah, it's a huge game for both. Yeah.
Yeah. Somebody's probably getting knocked out in that game. Yeah. They lose, probably eliminates them.
Yeah.
All right. Final one for you, and we'll let you get, you know, to work to your real job here. What is important in your mind for South Carolina over these next, you know, 3 days, starting tomorrow and through the championship on Sunday? Granted that they get there, we expect them to, but what in your mind is important for them to be able to win the title, but then looking to the NCAA tournament?
Yeah, I think this time of year, everybody's got tired legs and all that. So depth and defense are going to be the two things. You know, South Carolina has had the depth this year where they don't lose a lot when they go to the bench because of people, you know, like Ashlyn Watkins, Sanaya Fagan, Tessa Johnson, Malaysia Fulwiley. That second wave can really wear opposing teams down. And just defense, because at this time of year, yeah, some teams aren't going to have the legs, shots aren't going to fall. So you got to be able to play on the other end of the floor. Usually South Carolina does that pretty well. You've got to be able to win your matchups, not give up second chances. You know, you've got to prevent other teams from getting the offensive rebounds. And that has been a strength of this team over the last few years is depth and defense. And if you want to make a run in any kind of tournament, you're going to need both of those Ds here in the SEC tournament or anywhere else, but especially in the conference tournament where, you know, for South Carolina, they're hoping to play 3 games in 3 days. Other teams are hoping to play 4 games in 4 days and so on. But depth and defense for both, you know, is going to be the key.
Well, they've got that.
Yep.
They've got that. They've got depth, and they can play defense. And if it shows up, I'm not so sure anybody can beat them. Yep. So we'll see. This has got to be a lot of fun for you. Man, Gamecock basketball fans sure are lucky to have Brad Muller and Derek Scott as the voices of their teams. And we get to listen to both of you in March Madness this year, not just the ladies, the men are going to be in there too, so we'll have to get all this balanced out and figured out. The next few weeks could be a lot of fun. Brad, thank you. So I've been in that little room that you're in right there underneath the well multiple times, and it can get, hopefully the food's good. Do they have a good spread out there today?
They did. You know, I had my favorite food group, bacon, here this morning, so yeah. That's all I needed. I don't need much bacon. Cup of coffee, I'm good.
You know, the first time I was up there when I was at ESPN, I was I went for the 2017 first two, you know, the dance, the regional rounds, so the first two rounds of the dance when Frank's guys went to the Final Four. And I say this, and people, now everybody accuses me of giving it to Sendarius Thornwell. It's not like I hugged the guy. I wasn't within, you know, 50 yards of him outside of when he was on the floor, but I did catch the flu while I was up there. But I remember, you'll know exactly what I'm saying here. I remember that my first day there, I went downstairs and went to eat, get something to eat in the media room, and I had a water bottle. And again, I didn't have a voice, didn't feel very good. I was keeping my distance from everybody. I was up in the seats in the stands. Like, I wasn't courtside or anything like that. Mm-hmm. I wasn't that important, you know. They put us bumps behind the basket. And so I walked out on the floor. This is my first one, Brad. This is 7 years ago. Yeah. I walked out on the floor, and I about got tackled by three dudes who worked for the NCAA, who came storming over because I did not have my water in a blue NCAA cup.
That's correct. Yes.
Big no-no.
Oh, yeah.
Big no-no.
Yep.
And so I was like, dude, sorry, I didn't really think about it. You know, they're like, you have got to go back underneath there. If you bring that back out here again, we're going to have to throw it away. I was like, it's okay.
They are serious about that. Yes. They believe it.
I thought I was being safe by taking a water bottle, you know, with a cap on it. Nope. No.
Nope. Okay. Nope. Nope. That's big time, you know, business here at the NCAA tournament every year. That we that's the running gag from. Yeah, that continues to be the running joke.
Water in the cup, man. Blue cups matter. Yep. Brad, thanks so much for all your time. We probably kept you longer than we needed to, but we sure were glad to have you. Really appreciate your time, and we know you'll pull them through over the next 3 days.
Thanks for the time, guys. Appreciate it.
Yes, sir. We'll get you back before they, you know, I know they'll host, but We'll get you back sometime around the beginning of the tournament. We'll talk more.
Sounds great. Thanks so much, guys.
Thanks, Brad. There you go. The great voice of Gamecock basketball, Brad Muller. 12:33 here on this Thursday, March the 7th. JC is tending to a business matter. That's okay. Pat Bradley's still ahead at 1 o'clock. We'll hit a quick timeout. Don't worry. Mad Dog and myself will be right back on Inside the Gamecocks, the show powered by Electric Bikes of Charleston. It's 2024, and it's time to get in shape. Charleston Fitness Equipment can help you do just that in Mount Pleasant. The Wilkins family, big Gamecock fans and proud supporters of Carolina Rise and our programming on the Chief Sports Network. But most importantly, proud supporters of you getting healthy and staying healthy. CharlestonFitnessEquipment.com. Find them on the Chief Sports app and in Mount Pleasant. Happy New Year.
Hey, Gamecock fans, Mike Morgan here. During my time in Columbia, one of my favorite places to eat was Salsarita's. When I go back now for work or any other reason, it's still Salsarita's. Yeah, I'm like you. I love tacos. I love Tex-Mex. Where are you going to go to get them? Well, you've got two convenient Salsarita's locations, one in Lexington in the Target Center and one in West Columbia as well. Now, if you like tailgating, and who doesn't? Whether it's for a football game or anything else, they've got the catering hotline. Get yourself some Fiesta packs to take tailgating. Get yourself the Three Amigos bundles for tailgating. They make catering easy with a fresh, hot setup. And again, you just call the phone number 803-543-6297 to set it up. You can also look them up online, or you can even download the app. Salsarita's is just a cut above the rest. That's why they're serving Williams-Brice Stadium and the South Stands, also serving in the Colonial Life Arena. Again, that catering hotline number, make it easy for you and the folks out there. You don't need to settle for sandwiches every time. 803-543-6297. 803-543-6297.
Rescues and Resin, proud supporters of Carolina Rise. They are also proud partners of the show. They make products you can't get anywhere else. Custom designed wood and resin products that make your tailgate, make your home, or make anything stand out. Order a custom cutting board, coasters, wall art, tables, and more. Contact Dustin and Tabitha at rescuesandresin.com today. Rescuesandresin.com, and put your imagination to work. Rescues and Resin, proud partners of Inside the Gamecocks, the show.
Foul, nothing called, drive, bounces down low, shot, Michi will drive, kick in the corner, Cooper for three, it's up, it's good, Michi from 30 feet, got it, a dominating performance at home by South Carolina. They don't just beat Kentucky, they punch Kentucky in the mouth tonight, folks, and the number 16 in the nation will go down, and they will go down hard.
How do you like me now? Now that I'm on my way, you still think I'm
right? Look at that, man. Look what Lamont Paris has built on the men's side of things. We're used to seeing plenty of that on the women's, but some of those, some of those images just really. You know.
Yeah, typically this time of year, watching your bubble hopes burst, and now it's like, oh, you're in. How low's the number going to be, you know, next to your name?
I mentioned that to somebody a couple days ago. I said, in my lifetime, I've had this feeling, I think, four times, where it was like, they're in the tournament. We just don't know where they're going and what the seed's going to look like. I think, what was that? 04? Was that 04, Phil, where they got in, but I wasn't still a little bit uncomfortable. You didn't know what was going to happen. 96, 97 or 97, 98. We knew they were in, in 2017. And then, yeah, this year, every other year is you've been trying to figure out how they can get in.
Right.
They are in. There's no doubt. They are typically in.
Twisting your brain around to figure out who outside of the conference needs to lose for you to get in. And now it's just, you know, we've been trying to wrap our brains around all the metrics and stuff to figure out, well, how high can we go?
Yeah.
Which is a lot better because we, you know, we still would be talking, you know, the Clemson sweep over the weekend and lamenting that and trying to figure out how the baseball team is going to figure out something in years past. But now it's like, hey, everybody's on a fairly solid footing right now. So let's just keep it rolling. Just keep it rolling.
They have been able to do that. Pat Bradley coming up in 20 minutes. Did you get a chance to read the column that Chris Lowe wrote?
I was reading that yesterday while we were on the air. There were some pretty interesting things there in the middle of it with Coach Saban's, you know, and what really his decision to retire was about. I mean, I think he spoke to a lot of different issues that are going on in college football right now. And just what an incredible self-awareness this guy has, right? Mm-hmm. You know, and just is like, I'm just not going to be 100% at doing this at this point. And since I'm not going to be able to give everything I've got, then I'm out. I respect that. You know, I mean, I do. If you, you know, a lot of people hang on too long to whatever it is, not just coaches, but, you know, any number of fields that, you know, they have excelled in and just stay well past their prime and end up, you know, kind of fading away as opposed to just going out with a bang. But, you know, kudos to Nick Saban for knowing when his time was and being able to recognize that. I know it's not out of the ordinary to, you know, call Nick Saban.
I think
of strong mind or will, but I mean, it obviously speaks to what kind of a character and what he's got in between his ears.
I think that he's the only guy who can correct the overcorrection of college football. And because he's not scared, he has nothing to lose. Nothing. You can't do anything to him. All right. I mean, there's nothing you can do to Nick Saban. You disagree with him all you want. He didn't care about that. I mean, Nick Saban's the best college football coach that ever walked the planet. And he's incredibly smart, very influential. And name one thing that he ever said when he was firing warning shots that did not come true. Because you can't.
I mean,
nobody can name anything, right?
It's an old reference, but E.F. Hutton, I mean, when he speaks, the world listens.
Yeah, and there's a reason for that. And, you know, I thought probably the most telling, quote from that column was when after they lost in the semifinals, and he told Chris Lowe, he said, quote, I thought this when he got back to Tuscaloosa, and he said, and he met with the players, and it became apparent that his message wasn't resonating anymore, essentially, or like it was, but it wasn't like it once did. And this was his quote, if you haven't read it, quote, I thought we could have a hell of a team next year, and then maybe 70 or 80% of the players you talk to, all they want to know is two things. 70 or 80% of the players. Right. You know how good some of these kids are, by the way. Some of them probably suck, at least compared to the other dudes that they have at Alabama. I'm not so sure anybody that plays Alabama actually sucks, but you get my point.
Yeah.
And then some of them are probably your stars. But he said maybe 70 or 80% of the players you talk to, all they want to know is two things. What assurances do I have that I'm going to play because they're thinking about transferring? And how much are you going to pay me? Our program here was always built on how much value can we create for your future and your personal development, academic success in graduating, and developing an NFL career on the field. And he went on to say, so I'm saying to myself, maybe this doesn't work anymore, that the goals and aspirations are just different, and that it's all about how much money can I make as a college player. I'm not saying that's bad. I'm not saying it's wrong. I'm just saying that's never been what we were all about, and it's not while we had success through the years. And that was pretty telling, because when you look at college athletic, kind of going back to that big picture conversation we've had before, you know, Roy Williams, Mike Krzyzewski, Nick Saban. I mean, these are three of the best we've ever seen do what they do at any level of college athletics, and they've all dipped, and they've all referenced and at different points in times that this changing landscape basically was part of the reason. They might say, I don't even know if it's part of the reason. I mean, it might be the whole reason, Phil. Like, I'm done with this, and I've made a bunch of money, so I don't need to deal with it. Like, I'm out. But, yeah, you know, I'll still be around. It really terrifies me, and I hope that they find a way to overcorrect, and I think that he's one of the guys that can do it.
Yeah, I think so, too. I think if the NCAA or the conferences, as it seems to be swaying, were serious and trying to get to the bottom and fixing this, then he is the perfect person to...
He needs to be in the room.
Yeah, to be able to guide these discussions. His experience, his maturity, and the fact that, you know, I don't think that this is a guy who's going to come at it from, you know, like a university or a conference first mentality. Like, I just don't see him doing that. I think that he and you can tell in his words that he respects and appreciates the game of football, college football, to the point where he does not want to see it harmed in any way. And that is why, and one of the biggest factors that people need to listen to him, and not just listen to him, but to encourage and push him to be involved in any decision-making processes that there are at this point. Mm-hmm. Like, I mean, if you're not including him or at least extending an invitation to him, and you are in some sort of position to influence this game at this point in time, then you are definitely not doing your job.
Yep, it's and you're right. Like, he needs to be on the horn. I'm not so sure. You know, we know that the Big Ten and the SEC are trying to do their thing, and I mean the NCAA isn't, they're out of this. I mean, there's nothing they can do. They're just sitting there with their hands tied, hoping to not get sued, essentially. But like, you have to have these voices. I mean, you have to have them. I mean, he's done more for the good of college football than most anybody has done. And again, you know, a lot of the, I do think a lot of people are beginning to come around, and they're like, oh, okay, for the longest time, I thought the people were saying I'm totally against NIL and totally against the transfer portal. And, you know, like, and they're starting to realize that's not really what people have been saying. Like, it's not like there's a hard stance of against those things. What people are saying is there is no structure that surrounds any of this stuff. You know, you just, it's a free for all, and you've got state and state governments and agencies involved, and you got Congress involved, and but somehow the NCAA is not involved, but Congress is. I mean, that doesn't make any sense. So, you know, that's really where people have been like, look, we're just kind of, you take a walk and you decide that you're going to walk through the forest, but you don't really have you're not really following a path. You know, you just kind of end up where you end up, and you look around, you can't figure out how to get back where you were. And that's kind of where they've been with this thing. And so I don't know, he's always been so calculated, you know, like the great coaches are always very calculated.
Yes.
And a lot of coaches, like he took the job with ESPN. So he's going to be on College Game Day. Like, we're going to see him every Saturday during the fall. And we're going to see him multiple times during the week. I'm sure that he'll be doing Sports Center hits and things like that, right? College football final or whatever. They'll get his, you know, input on this, that, and the other. I'm sure he'll be at SEC Media Days on the SEC Network when that airs July, I think, 15th through the 18th. Like, you're going to see Nick Saban very visible and on national television with a platform and a microphone. So, but he doesn't have to step into those waters. Like, he doesn't have to go out and basically say, I mean, you can read the article over and over and try to interpret it different if you want to, but I'm not so sure that you can interpret it any differently than the way I did, which is I got tired of this crap and I got out. That's what happened. And so I'm not so sure that he didn't sit down with Chris Lowe, his probably most trusted source in the media, and say, I'm going to tell you, I'll tell you, and here's how I'm going to say it. I need people to hear this. Because, again, he doesn't have to say that. He can go live his life on the beach in Florida with $100 million in his bank account and not have to be bothered by anybody and not – who cares what happens with the future of college football? It ain't going to affect his life. His legacy's solid, done. He's good forever. So why did he do that? You know, it's very calculated, and maybe the answer is right around the corner.
Yeah, but I would expect that, you know, he is going to be involved in some decision making. What I like about him going to ESPN is here's a guy who's not afraid to say whatever it is on his mind, someone who's not going to be afraid of the mouse, but in a different way than like Pat McAfee, who is just, you know, there to be kind of the entertainment value and the, you know, kind of explosive guy. Saban is going to tell it like it is, right? I mean, we will get unvarnished opinions from Nick on anything that he speaks about.
Yeah.
And it will also be very conscientious and very well thought out. And it won't be said in a manner that's just to get clicks or just to attract any, you know, attention to what it is that he's doing, because he transcends all of the broadcasting BS, right? I mean, you know, it's not gonna get in his way. He's not going to have second thoughts about saying something on air because it's not like what he's trying to say is going to be, you know, vicious, you know, profanity laden, things like that. It's just going to be, you know, right.
It's going to be facts.
It's going to be, yeah, incisive, and it's going to be true.
Yeah, it's going to be facts is what it's going to be. Like, you ask me a question, you want me to give you an answer, right? Well, I'm going to give you the answer. Mm-hmm. And that's why they wanted to hire him, because they need that. Like, they, you know, not to get off track here from the general point of this, trying to fix whatever, like, you hear, if you listen to college football and Sirius or, you know, other shows, or, you know, if you've got some podcast or something you go and listen to, we're entering that time, right? You're already feeling it. You can, every one of them are giving you their take, which I'm not a big word of take, but they're giving you their take or their opinion or telling you what they think as far as the college football playoff and what we need to do about this and what we need to do about, like, we're not going to get bogged down in a ton of those discussions here because it doesn't matter. It really doesn't. Like, we'll have them, but probably not on the level that some of these other guys are having, because that's all they do is talk college football for 12 months a year and they don't have anything else to talk about. So they got to get deep into the weeds on all this stuff. But, you know, that, so you're hearing the, well, how do we solve it? And what do we do about this? And what do we do about that? And it's the same old stuff. It's just somebody saying it a little bit differently. And now you've got, you know, Nick Saban going to College Game Day, and that's why they hired him. Because, like, they shifted to the entertainment, probably a little bit too far to the entertainment side of things, right? And so now you've got this major crossroads in college football. Of what do we do about all this stuff? We're in college athletics, but college football is the most visible. What do we do about all this? I don't know. What do we do about it? We got conferences that are changing. We got this. We got NIL directing everything. Everybody's taking money under and on top of the table, of course. And we got the transfer portal, and everything's all screwed up. And I got players who. That's where. So, like, like ESPN will be able to balance out the entertainment side of college football, which is where the thing's been shifted for years. And then they'll be able to bring Nick Saban and put him in that chair and say, okay, now give us some facts so we can actually have a real discussion about this stuff with the guy who understands it better than everybody. I mean, like, I'm sorry, man. What set of nuts do you have at 18, 19 years old to walk into Nick Saban's office and say, yeah, man, you know, I'm glad to be here, but, you know, I want to know how much I'm going to play next year and how much money you're going to give me. I couldn't imagine. I'd be scared to death to say anything like that.
I mean, yeah, it's you just got to wonder, like, the people in some of these player circles, you know, that are like, well, you ought to be getting more money than that. Like, well, based on what, and how that, who are you? And how would you know what right. The value for this player on this team is? And you know, it just, it's crazy. I mean, and not only that, but then you got him wondering how long is he going to be around anyway, just because of his age. He spoke to the fact that it was even harder to pull coaches and things like that in to get good top quality coordinators for the same reason, because they wanted to know some guarantees that he would be around, you know, and it's just, you know, some of that's normal, but then the whole free market side of things where it's just the wild, wild west. I mean, that's completely new. And I think that he can influence the situation a lot better from outside of one of these universities than he would be from inside, even though the weight of what he said would be about the same. But I think now you're getting a more broad and general audience for what is going to be the most measured, least hyperbolic, you know, solutions that come out.
Yeah, it really is great. The Javar says, come teach high school. I got stories for days. Yeah, exactly. I tell you what, my kids won't. They'll never be like that.
I'm married to a high school teacher, so I know.
It baffles me.
You know, and I put it like this. It's not that they got big sets on them. They're just dumb. It doesn't have anything to do with bravery, you know, how much, you know, intestinal fortitude you have. You're just an idiot. You're ignorant and you're just an idiot. And nobody taught you any better than that at home.
That's the ticket. It's called parenting. It's called parenting. It has happened before. All right. It's 12:56. We do need to step aside. We will try to wrestle up JC if we can. Again, there's an announcement coming in an hour and 4 minutes pertaining to the some future happenings with the University of South Carolina. And he is dealing with much of that here in the final hour. So we will get him back at some point in time. But I know we are planning to have Pat Bradley here at the top of the 1 o'clock hour. Course saw what happened last night in Columbia with the Gamecocks falling to the Vols, who are now crowned regular season champions in the Southeastern Conference. Plenty of hoops on the way. We've got some Gamecock baseball stuff to get into as well. It is Thursday. Gamecock traditions will get you dressed and ready to roll if you're headed to the ballpark tomorrow to watch the first game of the Longwood series as they come to town to take on the Gamecocks, or if you're going to Greenville to watch the Lady G's play, or maybe you're going to head to Starkville or Nashville for the men's tournament. Who knows? Whatever it is, it doesn't matter. Or maybe you just want something for your birthday. You want to look good. Gamecock Traditions will keep you looking great. GamecockTraditions.com. All the newest and best goes there first. Located in Lexington, Village at Sandhill. Gamecock Traditions dresses all of us. We hope that it dresses you and your family as well. Time out. Pat Bradley up next.
Charleston Fitness Equipment is keeping South Carolina in shape. Clients have come from all over the Palmetto State to find that one piece of equipment that they enjoy that keeps them looking and feeling good. Whether it's a home rower, treadmill, elliptical, free weights, a home gym, or something else, Charleston Fitness Equipment keeps the mirror smiling back at you. Get in shape like the Gamecocks do. Visit CharlestonFitnessEquipment.com. Gamecock owned and operated and proud partners of Inside the Gamecocks, the show.
The preferred sign partner of Gamecock Athletics is Signorama Columbia, and they should be yours too. A full-service sign company that handles design, production, install, and service, Signorama Columbia has helped to bring to life the perfect vision for so many all across South Carolina. Owned and operated by proud Gamecock alumni, they can handle all types of signage, including interior and exterior, vehicle graphics, and more. Go to signorama.com and find the West Columbia location or call them at 803-407-9284. Bring your brand to life with Signorama Columbia and go Gamecocks.
Cole Joel here, and when I'm not eating average jambalaya or celebrating endless summer in Destin, I like to eat pimento cheese straight out the bucket. And the only pimento cheese I like to eat is from Nana's Porch. It's award-winning, it'll melt in your mouth, it's good on a cracker, it's good in a bowl, it's good on a piece of bread. Also, don't forget, Nana's Porch has a hell of a food truck. It's award-winning as well, and they're here for all of your catering needs. So get online, nanasports.com. It's good. Coach O signing off. Endless summer, go Tiger.
For chicken cock, we get a medium to medium plus toast. The char level, we use a number 3 level char. If you char too deep, you start burning away some of those flavor components that you just created. If you just char a barrel and you don't toast it, you're going to create some of those flavors just on a thin layer, just inside the char, but not the actual depth and full extent of flavors that you're going to get if you toast it properly. All those elements, that's exactly what they do. They boil down to great flavor.
If you're in the real estate market in the Lowcountry or even in the Midlands, please contact me, JB, with Coast to Coast Realty SC. Go Gamecocks.
This break is presented by Billy G's Carolina Barbecue, the state newspaper's 2023 winner for best catering, best barbecue, and best food truck. Visit BillyG'sCarolinaBarbecue.com for all of your catering needs.
Ladies and gentlemen, here it is.
With a little love and some tenderness, we'll walk upon the water, we'll rise above the mist. With a little peace and some harmony, we'll take the world together, we'll take them by the hand.
It is the final hour of Inside the Gamecocks, the show from the Signorama Studios. A reminder that Dixie Vodka serves the Chief Sports Network, made in Charleston, South Carolina. Dixie Vodka, serving spring wherever you are. Pat Bradley joining us from the SEC Network, one of the great voices of college basketball. We had him once. I told him I'd have him back again, and of course wasn't so sure if he cared enough to come back, but he did accept, so it makes me feel like we did our job the first go around. But Pat, man, we can't thank you enough. How you doing?
Doing good. How you boys doing? Can you hear me good? Well?
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Are you on the road? Where are you at today?
I'm back in Boston briefly, then to Nashville tomorrow. Doing the Florida Vandy game.
Lost him.
Did we lose him? What in the world happened there? I think we lost.
Bad cell zone or something.
He might be in a bad cell zone. Yeah. See if we can't. Dial that up. So he's got Florida Vandy at 4:30 on the SEC Network on Saturday up in Nashville.
I'm back here. You boys here?
Oh, there you are. Yeah. There you are. There you are. Okay, so you're going to Nashville for the Florida Vandy game.
Florida Vandy, yes. And then back to the house to pick up some clothes and then back for the SEC tournament.
And then back to Nashville.
Yes, exactly. Exactly.
Because you would have to stay. Let's see, the tournament starts what, Tuesday, right? Isn't that right?
Wednesday night we'll have. So let me pull up the schedule now. Wednesday night we'll have the first round of games.
That's right, Wednesday. Okay.
Yeah, Wednesday. Okay. Night, first round of games.
Yeah, I would leave too, dude. Because if you left me alone for 3 or 4 days in Nashville with nothing to do, I'd probably wouldn't.
Exactly.
Yeah, I get that. All right, PB. Well, like I said, we're glad to have you back. Last night, South Carolina had a chance to take down the Vols for the second time this year and move on to Starkville this weekend, where if they would win again, they'd clinch at least a share of the regular season championship, which is really just still remarkable to even think about in Lamont Paris's second year. But they didn't get it done. Tennessee is really good, and they are earning it down the stretch, aren't they, PB? 14-3 in the league, and they've won, I think, 7 straight, and the last 3 have been over the likes of Auburn in Tuscaloosa and now in Columbia, South Carolina, and they got the Wildcats coming up this weekend. So that 7-point loss last night for Carolina, or 7-point win for Tennessee, tell us what you saw.
Well, I think, going back to the first game, it was a well-fought game, another low-scoring game. When South Carolina went to Tennessee, they won 63-59. Tennessee shot poorly. From the 3-point line, they shot poorly from the free throw line. Zakai Ziegler and Jonas Adu did not have a good game for South Carolina. I mean, Miles Studi, I believe he was 3 or 4 from the 3-point line. I think South Carolina made 10 threes. That's at Knoxville. Like, it doesn't happen very often. So I felt like South Carolina played really, really well, and they had to go there and win that game. So, you see a little bit of a flip of the script last night. I think Zakai Ziegler had a fantastic game on the road, which you have to do, from a point guard situation. Mitchie Johnson did not have – strangely enough, he has 18 points, but he goes over 7 from the free throw line. I mean, 3-point line, which is unlike him. So he makes, one, two of those, and South Carolina wins. I mean, fellas, it's a 2-possession game. You look at it, and South Carolina played, well enough to win the game despite only scoring 59. But, they're a team that can win those types of games. So when you look at it, I think it was the combination of, Tennessee, Dalton Connect makes, one, two big shots that puts them over the edge because, like I said, I mean, South Carolina was right there in position to win that game.
Yeah, I think you hit the nail on the head. I mean, we talked about this earlier when we opened up at 11 o'clock this morning, and I was telling JC and Phil, and JC's not in right now. He's kind of dealing with some behind-the-scenes stuff going on with the Gamecocks. But I thought it was pretty simple, Pat. They missed a couple of open shots. I mean, yesterday our buddy Derek Scott, who's the voice of Gamecock basketball, was on the air, and he threw out an incredible stat. Something you can use if you'd like going forward. I don't think he's going to ask for any royalties on this. That when the Gamecocks shoot 34%, that's it, 34% from long range, they are 17-0 this year.
Yeah.
And
well, because they get open shots. It's like, it's funny. The difference for me, the NBA and college basketball, like I've always felt like college basketball is a game of mistakes. And the team that makes the least mistakes will win. The NBA, it's a make or miss league. you're going to get open shots. The players and the coaches are the highest level. They're going to get open shots. It's just, are you going to make them or not? Mm-hmm. But in South Carolina, they're so patient and smart when they run their offense. They don't turn it over a lot. They don't rush shots. They're patient. They're going to get good shots. So they're a make or miss team. It's like, are you going to make a miss? Like, we're going to get good shots. It's just a matter of if we make them or not, which is not a lot of college teams are like that. Believe it or not, it just doesn't happen. So to your point, yes, you're right. And, you know, Tennessee is such a good defensive team. Like, we're talking about Tennessee's a Final Four team. I mean, come on.
Right. Like, agree.
I mean, they're just so good defensively. So, you know, I'm looking at the numbers now. You go 8 for 29 from the three-point line. Sure, you shoot more threes probably because the defense is so good. They protect the paint so well. You got to rely on that. You shoot 27%. You're right. You make two more of those threes. We're talking about a W today. I mean, that's how close of a game it was.
That's exactly right. That 8 of 29, I think, was put Carolina somewhere in 27% or something like that. But had they hit two more, they would have been at that 34%. And you without the free throws at the end of the game that the Vols had to shoot, I don't know if the Gamecocks would have won the game or not. But but they sure wouldn't have been 2 or 3 possessions down with 45 seconds to go. But
this just goes to show you how good of a team South Carolina still is. You know, I mean, you can't win them all.
Oh, don't tell the fans. Well,
don't tell Don Staley that.
Well, that's
right. Yeah, right. Yeah. I know we might be lost on Coach Staley.
We just talked to Brad Muller a minute ago, who's their play-by-play guy. And I said, Brad, what's your record as the voice of the Gamecocks, by the way? He said, well, I've been doing this for 17 years. You know, when Don got here, it wasn't as pretty as it is now. Yeah, well, we remember that. But now they don't lose, or at least they're hoping not to.
I mean, I think this year is the craziest because in years past, like, they've had a pretty, you know, dominant force. And, you know, I'm obviously knee-deep in you know, SEC men's hoops, but they just seem, at the beginning of the year, I mean, you guys tell me, it seems like that they weren't projected to be as dominant as they are right now.
Interesting. Relative to expectations, Pat, they were not. We lost all 5 starters on that women's team from last year. Brought in, you know, a transfer to run point. You know, the teams have had a fairly similar track this year. You know, just overperforming preseason expectations for what they were, obviously, relative to where the program was going in. I don't think there's anybody down here in South Carolina not happy with basketball right now.
No. 53-6 combo record between the two.
How's baseball projected this year?
Well, they got to get it going offensively right now. I mean, they're good. I mean, they're
top 25.
If they swing it the way they're supposed to.
I know that's a sore subject after winning back-to-back championships a few years ago. I know everybody's expecting them to be world beaters every year.
you know how it works. You know, I mean, but they should be. I mean, they should be right in the thick of it. They got to get it going offensively right now. But, you know, when you have an All-American hitting third and an All-American hitting fourth, you'll figure it out. And,
that's pretty good, yeah. Well, you need pitching. I mean, obviously, we know that. I mean, that's as good as gold, man. When you get a deep – that's why I think my Razorbacks this year are so highly rated, right? Because they get some pitching.
Yeah, absolutely. Matter of fact, here, we'll just extend the invite now. So Arkansas comes to Founders Park the weekend that Carolina plays their spring game, and then we have our golf tournament that Monday, April 22nd. You should come spend the weekend in Columbia. We'll treat you to a round of golf, a football game, a baseball game, whatever
you
want.
Let's do it. I love it. I love Columbia's one of my favorite. Columbia is – it's got to be top 4 SEC cities. I've recently fallen in love with Baton Rouge.
Mm-hmm.
Easy. Nashville, I always love. Traffic is getting so, so very, very difficult in Nashville, though. I mean, come on, Nashville.
Yeah.
But Columbia, South Carolina is something special. The palmetto trees. I mean, come on. It's just nothing like it.
You're making a lot of friends around here. There's going to be a lot of people who want you to. They're going to kick me and Phil to the curb.
So can I get on the sidelines for the football game? You think Coach Beamer will let Razor back on the sidelines?
Pretty sure we could probably pull that off for you. Yeah, I think we can make that happen. Now, whether Shane lets me down on the sidelines, I'm not sure.
Yeah,
you know,
right. Critical. That'd be a little easier.
No. I talked to Shane last week. He actually did something for my family that I can't thank him enough for. But it's not me. It's really more. We put it on JC. If anything bad happens around here with football, we pin that on JC.
We need a fall guy.
Yeah, he's the fall guy. You know, we can't throw it on Mike.
Every crew that's ever been successful has always had a fall guy. And you need one. Every crew needs one.
Well, we would try to pin it on Mike Morgan, but nobody would believe it. So,
Mike Morgan, what's he? Is he getting his massage right now? Is that why he's not on?
I don't know what he's
getting
doing,
his hair done.
Probably. He'll pick up
in whatever cities he's in.
Is he over at Brent Skinner's B Skinner's place picking out a new suit for the postseason?
For dinner.
Just for dinner. You're over there having martinis and shrimp cocktail and everything.
You never know with Mike, man. He'll send
us
a message.
I'm expecting two suits from Brent Skinner. He's supposed to ship them up to me tomorrow. So,
oh, fantastic!
Yeah,
that's awesome. That's great to hear. We'll we'll promote that. So, hey, Pat, this league clearly is nuts, man. I mean, this is as deep as I can probably remember. At least the top being. I know that down there at the bottom of the league, Missouri is. Just couldn't get it going. I think that jump shot that Jacoby Wright hit in the third league game of the year kind of put them behind the eight ball a little bit, and then they could never get it going. Bandy's clearly had their issues. We'll have to spend another 30 minutes one day on what in the world happened with your Razorbacks, because I don't think anybody can figure it out.
I'll say this. Like you mentioned Missouri, Vandy. So I did a Missouri game. I've done four or five Vandy games. Haven't done an Arkansas game, but I'm obviously close to the program. Mm-hmm. I've done Georgia games. I'm looking at the bottom of the seating. And it's amazing to me. And I did a lot of South Carolina games last year. I did maybe three or four. So South Carolina last year was obviously they were picked to finish last. By the way, I didn't, just for the record. It was the other media guys. But so I was around the program when they were, in the some of the last place standings. Never once did I go to a shoot around or a practice or a game where I didn't see Coach Lamont Paris like not have his guys engaged. Every guy had his chin up. Missouri, I did the game on Saturday against Ole Miss. All chins were up. All guys were aggressive, fighting. I mean, their shoot around lasted an hour and a half. They were dripping sweat. They were ready to go. Same for Vanderbilt. Same for Georgia. Ole Miss. Like, so it really struck me as the difference is I've been around teams who've quit and I've seen it in their eyes. I've done games where coaches have basically just canceled shoot around because they knew like, we got no chance. I'm done. It's really refreshing to see. And Arkansas is like that too. Like they play with, I mean, their hair is on fire and it's like, you guys aren't going to the NCAA tournament, but they're excited. Like they play crazy. So I hope we get a great following Wednesday in Nashville. I know the Razorback fans always show up. I hope Missouri and Vandy's going to be playing, so, you know, in Nashville. But that's what really stood out to me when I've done games of those teams. They're still engaged and fighting and playing. So that just tells me what kind of coaches you have. And I go back to Coach Lamont Paris last year. Dude was like, he's the same this year as he was last year.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
It's same guy, same attitude, same approach. He's got different personnel. Right. You know, he identified his weakness and he brought in guys who are better decision makers. And, you know, it resulted in more W's, but Coach Paris is the same guy. And I respect him so much for that. He you know, he reminds me, I've talked to him a couple of times. He reminds me of my college coach, Nolan Richardson, who, you know, I think Coach Richardson was a little bit more, abrasive, a little bit deeper voice than Coach Paris, but they approach it similar. Certainly their offense is similar with the five out, player movement, ball movement, read and react. That's what I love about what he does is it's you teach a player how to read and react versus teach them A goes to B, B goes to C, C goes to D, and then we shoot. You teach them the game. You know, one of the first things when Coach Richardson was sitting in my living room, he said, what we try to do is we want to not give a kid a fish and feed him for a day. We want to teach him how to fish and feed him for a lifetime. And that's the way he coached. And that's, I think that's what Coach Paris does too.
That's a clip there, Phil. Save that because Nolan Richardson and Lamont Paris in the same breath, and it's coming from a guy who played for Nolan Richardson. I think that's incredibly interesting. It's been fascinating to watch this group come together and do what they've done, Pat, because they have a seemingly night in and night out, even in their losses like last night. They always have somebody different who's kind of stepping up to the plate. They do have an emerging what I would call future probably superstar in Colin Murray Boyles. How about his game? You've seen him this year grow up. What do you think about him?
Well, I mean, when we started calling him CMB, once you start going by your initials, you know, everybody knows who you are.
You can play.
But again, though, it's not like God gave him athleticism, size. You know, his family gave him that, all right, his genetics. But what separates him is his vision. And I had one of the more influential guys in my life in basketball was a guy named Andy Stoglin. And he always says, you know, the most important things for a basketball player are your eyes, your feet, and your hands. And Colin has, you know, the good Lord gave him the feet, the hands, and he's got great vision. So you watch him, and he makes the right pass. He understands, like, defensively, he's getting better, right? So I was around, a few other coaches, and they tried to, because he's a freshman, you know, you try to expose freshmen defensively because that's a lot of times the most – difficult transition from high school to college is, you know, you can get away with things defensively and offensively, but, you know, you can get exposed defensively really quick, and he's figuring that out. But I think his vision is pretty uncommon when you realize, you know, the type of player he is. So yeah, he is a superstar, but it has a lot more to do with his vision of the game and making the right decisions. It's a game of decisions. Coach Richardson would always say, fellas, it's a game of decisions. The better decision-making team is going to win most of the time. Now, talent, yes, most coaches will take talent over anything. But if you can find somebody who's got talent and decision-making, you're going to have yourself a hell of a squad. And Lamont Paris has brought in good decision-makers. Talon Cooper, Michi, the fact that Michi, you know, I'm so happy that Michi came and stayed, you know, in this world of transfers. I'm so happy that he stayed because he is, from last year to this.
I don't know
where he's going to end up, like in terms of professional basketball, but he has improved his stock so much, showing what else he can do other than just catch and shoot and score.
I hated it for him that last night he was 0 of 7 from long range. I thought it was going to be a big night for him. And, you know, a couple of them he just couldn't get to go down. But, I mean, he's got range upon range. I mean, it's incredible to watch. So, everything you mentioned there, and you got versatility with B.J. Mack. We know how they play defense. We know at the pace in which they play, Pat. And combining what we've described with and discussed with the rest of the league, I mean, Tennessee, Auburn, Kentucky, Alabama, Florida. I wouldn't want to play Mississippi State in the postseason. I can tell you that. No. These guys, like, when you look at South Carolina, knowing Gamecocks are, this is about to be.
I'm going to tell you, they're a sneaky Final Four team, like, because they can play. The thing about South Carolina is they're physical. Okay, so in the NCAA tournament, there's not a lot of fouls that are going to be called. They're going to let you play.
Mm-hmm.
That's different than, like, you know, they're going to let you play. South Carolina is a physical team, number one. Number two, they got great guard play. Talon Cooper is number two, I think, in the SEC, assist to turnover ratio. Michi Johnson has played point guard position. Jacoby Wright is playing, like, this kid is. I mean, somebody should give this kid a gold chain. I know probably NIL should. Brent Skinner should give him something because he's just played so well. I mean, he hit a game-winning shot this year. He's played so well. So you got great guard play. Josh Gray is – and so you got guys that are physical, take care of the basketball. They don't turn – you know, no turn it over. They're patient on offense. So my point is, you get in the NCAA tournament, you can play against any style of team. Like, so it's six, you got to win six games in 3 weeks. They can match up against anybody. Now, you know, what they don't have, you know, is a lot of rim protection. It's just CMB and Josh Gray, really the only rim protectors you have. So, yes, if you play against a team, you know, maybe that could be an issue, but you've got 3-point shooters, Michi, Studi, Cooper, Wright can make some. Zachary Davis has been one of the great, most improved players in the league stories. So, BJ Mack is probably the X factor, to be honest with you, because he's sort of that mismatch. He's a big man, but he's not really a big man. Like,
right,
you know, at 6'7", I mean, he could be their center, but then again, he plays outside the 3-point line. So, I mean, if that dude goes 3-for-5 or 3-for-6 from the 3-point line in an NCAA tournament game, you're winning that game.
Mm-hmm.
So, I mean, it's fun. It's, I mean, I hope all these things come to fruition. You know, it was 2017 when. To sin was to win with Sindarius Thornwell, the great Sindarius. Mm-hmm. So, you know, who knows? We may be back there again. That was an unlikely situation, but
yeah,
we may be back there again.
Well, it was. I mean, it really is neat this time of year for Gamecock fans. It's because it's rare to be sitting here at the beginning of March going, well, we're in the tournament. We just don't know where we're going and what seed we're going to be. So they have one game left in Starkville, and it's difficult, as we all well know. Carolina, if you're pulling for anything this weekend, as we pointed out multiple times today, You got to have to, you need to pull for Kentucky to lose as much as you're pulling for South Carolina to win, as that'll give you the double bye up in Nashville next week in the SEC tournament. But Pat, with one game left, win or lose, and then one or two games or whatever that it may be in the SEC tournament, win or lose, I know you're not necessarily Joe Lunardi, but do you
I do get his emails. Right.
I get them too. And I'll tell people sometimes, by the way, South Carolina is projected on the 5 line. Well, how do you know that? It's not on Twitter. I'm like, because I get the emails. You know,
right.
Maybe I don't have to go to Twitter for my news. So, where do you feel like they're kind of settled?
By the way, so yeah. Twitter, right? Everybody's like, I'm all over Twitter more than Instagram, Facebook. That's where you go get your info, right?
Yeah, I guess so. These days, yeah.
It's at least where it starts. And then you got to click on the articles and actually read them, Pat. I think that's what separates people on Twitter.
You guys read them?
it's like Playboy. Who reads the articles, right?
That's good.
Regarding Tennessee, Pat, one thing we've been talking, and I mean, you would have more experience being kind of in it and a little closer to it than we are, but Tennessee runs the table. They're going to move them up into a top four overall seed, right? They're going to be on a one line.
Yeah, I mean, my man Jimmy Dykes was pushing for that all broadcast last night.
Yeah,
number one seed.
I said it earlier in the week. I'm like, because when you're looking at it, they'd be on an 11 game heater. I mean, and how do you say no to that?
Yeah, well, you got
what is one of the stronger conferences, right?
Yeah, well, I'm actually looking at the Lenardi sent something out, I guess, yesterday at 11 p.m. He's got Tennessee on the one seed line right now with UConn, Houston, Purdue. That makes sense. Personally, to me, 1-2 doesn't matter to me that much in terms of like your success in the tournament. Like it matters for your program, how you promote your program. We're a one seed. You put that in the media guide. You tweet that out. You tell recruits, you know, and you know, your fan base and everybody loves it. But in terms of success in NCAA tournament, probably doesn't matter. I don't know what the numbers show over the like historical statistics, but I would imagine it probably wouldn't matter that much. But yeah, in terms of just promotion wise, it's good for your program.
Yeah, Pat, I can't remember. I'm pretty sure, if I'm not mistaken, it was 2008 was the last time there were 4-1 seeds in the Final Four.
Wow.
Kansas won the national championship that year. And Coach Cal was at Memphis. I remember they were in it. Roy Williams had North Carolina in it. And then UCLA. UCLA was the fourth one. Remember, it was all blue. I'm not saying blue bloods necessarily, but so that had to be the last year. I don't think since then. I think we got close a few years ago. You remember when Duke won it?
Yeah.
What was that, Pat? 2015, 2016, somewhere in there?
Right.
And I think there were three. Lamont Paris was in the Final Four that year because I know Wisconsin went.
Yeah.
And I know Kentucky.
A rear red team.
That's right. That's right. And I'm not so sure that there's been three. There wasn't a one seed last year.
No.
I know that. So,
and you probably, you know, this year there's no dominant team when, you know what I'm saying? So you probably won't have, you could have all ones. I mean, heck, but you could not. You could have, a sneaky South Carolina team can get in there. People think Kentucky got a chance. Kentucky is such a good offensive team, man. Like, I don't know, everybody bashes their defense, but all you have to do when you really break it down and you look at possessions, all you got to do is get two stops. And that gets you, like, it's a last night, South Carolina, Tennessee. South Carolina gets two more defensive rebounds, you know, or take away or whatever it is, you know, or Dalton Connect misses one and Ziegler misses that tough shot at the end of the first half. Remember the buzzer beater at the first half he made?
Yeah.
That's the difference.
That one and that falling away on Connect on that three right in front of their bench late in the game. I'm like, how do you even defend right. that?
So you know? I was talking to Dennis Gates and on Saturday they were playing Ole Miss and they've been in a lot of games. Haven't won a conference game. I go, Coach, what do you think? Like what's the difference? In winning those and losing those, and he just says plays make plays. It's like these are smart guys. They all draw up great plays. They all have great plays. You know, some guys have a Dalton Connect or a Zakai Ziegler at the end of the game, or Michi Johnson has made big shots. Talon Cooper has made big shots. You know, sometimes they make them. Sometimes they don't. I know that's difficult for fans to process or us to process, but it's the truth sometimes.
I think it's exactly right. I mean, I don't think this makes me a basketball expert in any way, shape or form, but I said the same thing earlier to Phil and JC at the top of our programming earlier. Look, especially this time of the year, you want to win conference championships. You want to win tournament championships. You want to dance and keep dancing. You got to hit shots. Yeah. Period. I mean, there's no other way around it. Like that's what makes the NCAA tournament what it is. The highlights aren't from, you know, six passes and a layup. The highlights are guys hitting shots. That's what it's all about. And so they're gonna have to do that. All right, final question. I know you got to go, man, but we really appreciate you. Speaking of dancing, we've danced all over the place over the last 30 minutes or so. But how do you think this thing shakes out this weekend? From a seeding standpoint, with the Gamecocks, Auburn, Kentucky, Alabama, all at 12-5, Wildcats have to go to Knoxville and take on the SEC champion Vols, and then of course Florida is still kind of sitting there in the wings because they're at 11-6, and you know they're hoping some good things happen their way too. Carolina could be 2 or 6 in next week's SEC tournament, Pat. It's a pretty wild scenario. One game left, 2 or 6.
I think. Well. Here's, you know, South Carolina going to Mississippi State. Mississippi State is a team right now that is going to be hungry. I mean, the hump is going to be difficult just because they're coming off of an L, you know, loss. And you know, Chris Jans is one of the best in the business. Nobody better than him. So that's just going to be a very difficult environment. Florida is going to be interesting because they're probably the team that's under the radar. You mentioned them. They're under the radar. I mean, Arkansas, Alabama, I figure Bama's going to win that. A&M coming off a win against a desperate team, Ole Miss. I expect Ole Miss to be able to take care of business. So I'm going with all the home teams on Saturday.
I'll put Carolina in
the Florida Vandy game. That game is going to be the one that sticks out to me because Florida's playing as good as anybody and they're flying under the radar. Nobody's talking about them, but they are a well-balanced team. They've got size. They've got physicality. You want to put Florida in your back pocket for the NCAA tournament of a team that can make some noise because they can beat you multiple ways. They're great. They don't have to shoot the ball well. Great offensive rebounding team. So they can get you second chance opportunities. They can shoot it good. They got really big, strong, good guards. So keep them in your when you're filling out your bracket, if you want to take a shot on Florida.
Yeah, they can play. There's no doubt. They can score too. Vandy's been putting some points on the board, as a matter of fact, in their last few contests, and they're going to try to do that. You'll call that game at 4:30 on the SEC Network on Saturday, immediately following the Gamecocks trip to Starkville. So if you've got the SEC Network turned on Saturday afternoon, I think Damian Fishback and Kevin Fitzgerald have South Carolina's keep it on because Pat Bradley's coming
come
up next.
Come over and say hello to me if you're in Nashville. Come over and say, come to Memorial Coliseum.
Yeah, come exactly. And then we'll bring him to Columbia for golf, baseball, and the spring game in April.
I love it.
By your scenario, by the way, if that happens, if the Vols beat Kentucky, Auburn and Alabama both win at home, which I expect them to, if that all happens, Carolina wins or Carolina loses in Mississippi State, at Mississippi State, they would still, I think, be in the top four seeds. Because Kentucky, they would have the head-to-head over Kentucky and Florida. So that would put them in there.
Well, I'll let you figure that out because I was told there would be no math, and I'm glad for that.
Sorry, the check's in the mail. Hey, man, really, really do appreciate all your time. We always do this. We tell everybody 20 minutes, and then 40 minutes later, we have to apologize for it. But it does mean a lot that you accept our invitation.
Well, I appreciate it, fellas. You guys do a good job. I love Columbia, and I would love to spend more time down there.
Yeah. Hey, seriously,
the palmetto trees are unbelievable.
Put it on the put it on. I don't mind. You know, put it on your radar if you don't have anything to do. April 20th through the 22nd, you got the spring game and in Arkansas, South Carolina baseball. We certainly handle tickets for that, and
do they have a Sunday? Are they playing on Sunday? Because my brother, they're doing their birthday. My brother and his son, they're doing their birthday party on that weekend.
Mm-hmm.
But
they're
in Miami, so I could scoot up to South Carolina maybe on the Sunday.
Yeah, I think it's a 1:30 or 2:00 first pitch on that Sunday. I'll have to confirm.
We'll work on it.
We'll work on it. Should be a good series. Hopefully, they're both playing well when it happens. But safe travels wherever the hell you're going. I know you're going to Nashville at some point, but you're in Boston now. And so however you work that out, we hope it's safe.
All right, boys. Appreciate it.
All right. All right, Pat.
Hey,
thanks for everything you do. You're a joy to watch and listen to on the network, man. It makes it a lot of fun for us.
All right, brother. I appreciate you guys.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Mm-hmm. You go. Pat Bradley from Beantown.
Yeah, man.
He stuck around with us. So in the last 18 hours or so, we've had Jimmy Dykes mention that he thinks the Gamecocks are a Sweet 16 team. And Pat Bradley went further than that to say he thinks that this is another group that could make it to the Final Four. Tells you how much respect they have for these Gamecocks.
I know.
That's pretty neat. For those that haven't maybe missed that, that was pretty special. And for those that didn't listen, shame on you. We'll get Alex or somebody to write a column and put it up on the Pigsburg a little bit later on. So, all right, let's step aside, Phil. I know we got to get some breaks in here, and we'll begin to wind things down. We got some Carolina baseball to get into as well. It is 1:40, and it is a beautiful Thursday afternoon here in March. Hang tight. Inside the Gamecocks, the show. We'll be right back.
Down here in the South, we don't always see eye to eye. While our taste in college football teams, or what sauce, if any, goes best on a rack of ribs, or what to mix with our Dixie vodka might be up for debate, we can all agree there's nothing better than a Southern tailgate. And like our favorite college teams, our ingredients come from small towns and big cities. They're grown in Southern soil, are crafted by Southern hands, and proudly represent the South in our backyard and beyond. So raise a glass of Dixie Southern Vodka to celebrate being made in America and raised in the South.
It's the season of love, and there's no sweeter time and place to feel it than today at Love Chevrolet, the heart-pounding rumble of the Silverado High Country, the captivating 2024 Chevy Trax SUV, most affordable in its class. No matter what features you're looking for in a brand new Chevy, your match is waiting for you right now at Love Chevy. In this 63rd season of love, your trusted hometown Chevy dealer is proud to carry on the tradition of honesty, integrity, and treating customers like family. No fast talk, no gimmicks, no ridiculous add-on stickers. Simply the best selection of new Chevys at South Carolina's number one volume Chevy dealer right now and ready to drive home today. Don't forget about the $1,000 low price guarantee. Wow.
There's a lot to love about Love Chevy. I-26 at Harbison and at lovechevy.com. Together, let's drive. That's the power of love.
Love Chevy. Electric Bikes of Charleston offers the most fun you'll ever have on two wheels. Magnum, Velotric, Aventon Bikes, and more. And they sell to consumers all across the state and offer outstanding warranties and service after the sale. Five levels of pedal assist plus a throttle help you handle the southern heat better, but still get great exercise. Bikes are available all ages and sizes. ElectricBikesCharleston.com or stop into their store in Mount Pleasant. Electric Bikes of Charleston, powering inside the Gamecocks, the show.
Hey Gamecock Nation, my name is Kyle, longtime listener of the show and avid golfer. I wanted to take my game to the next level, but let's face it, golf is a hard game to learn on your own. I heard the ad from McKellar Enterprises and reached out to the owner and former Gamecock golfer, Meredith Taylor. In just 2 months of working with Meredith, I shot my lowest round ever, and I've never felt more confident in my golf game. So if you're looking to take your game to the next level, go to McKellarEnterprises.org and book your lesson today with former Gamecock golfer, Meredith Taylor. Go Gamecocks.
Chicken cock originated in Kentucky, like so many other bourbons. And so the resurrection of it, you know, Paris, Kentucky, that's the county seat of Bourbon County. So much of this whiskey was being made in that Bourbon County, put on ships and barges and shipped down Ohio, down the Mississippi, and got to New Orleans, where it got distributed all over the world. And people kept saying, well, hey, I want some more of that whiskey from Bourbon County. And so that's how bourbon whiskey got its name. And chicken cock originated actually in Paris, Kentucky, which is today Bourbon County.
If you're in the upstate of South Carolina and are in need of residential real estate services, Cindy Bass, Searfoss of Caldwell Banker Kane is for you. Ask her about the Village at Creekside, all of her listings in my hometown of Spartanburg, South Carolina, right there on Daniel Morgan Avenue, married to a lifelong Gamecock fan. And many of our listeners have already bought homes from her and been 100% satisfied with the detail and care she uses. Cindy Searfoss, 864-414-5271, Caldwell Banker Kane in the upstate for your real estate needs.
Building your dream home is often just that, a dream, and sometimes a nightmare. But at the Barn Door Company, they commit to quality and build without sacrifice. Customization, open floor plans, limitless flooring options, maintenance-free and easy insulation perks, and affordability are just a few reasons why they've been named one of the best builders in the U.S. Believe in your dreams. Visit thebarndominiumco.com. That's thebarndominiumco.com. The Barn Door Company. Gamecock-owned. Gamecock-operated. The preferred sign partner of Gamecock Athletics is Signorama Columbia, and they should be yours too. A full-service sign company that handles design, production, install, and service, Signorama Columbia has helped to bring to life the perfect vision for so many all across South Carolina. Owned and operated by proud Gamecock alumni, they can handle all types of signage, including interior and exterior, vehicle graphics, and more. Go to signorama.com and find the West Columbia location or call them at 803-407-9284. Bring your brand to life with Signorama Columbia and go Gamecocks.
What's up to the best fans in the country? This is Eli Jones, and you're tuned in to Inside the Gamecocks, the show. Go Cocks.
Final segment, Thursday afternoon. Welcome back inside the Gamecocks, the show. JC is set to help get some things rolled out here in just a few minutes. And so he will not be rejoining us, but he will be here tomorrow to fill you in with all the details.
pertaining to the announcement coming from South, well, you know, from those affiliated with South Carolina. Thanks to Pat Bradley and Brad Muller for both joining us today. A lot of basketball. Gamecock women set to go tomorrow. South Carolina set to go to Starkville tomorrow to play on a Saturday. So if you missed that conversation with Pat Bradley, it was really neat and covered a lot of ground. He even asked us about the Gamecock baseball team. So I thought that was interesting. Stuart Lake will join us tomorrow. We also have a couple of other things that we just really can't confirm just yet. Again, kind of related to all this stuff it's about to come out here in just a little bit. And so once that announcement is made, we'll firm up the rest of what tomorrow will look like. I do know, though, that tomorrow night there will be South Carolina baseball at Founders Park. And Carolina is trying in these last few non-conference games to really get some things clicking. They did win to get their 10th win of the year last night, 4-1 over Davidson, only played six innings because of the rain. Longwood is up next, and then they'll head to North Augusta's SRP Park next week to take on Georgia Southern in a neutral site game. And then it's on to Oxford, where the Rebels of Ole Miss, who are off to a 9-5 start this season, await the Gamecocks. Both have had their struggles, and it just continues offensively for USC. Yesterday in that 4-1 victory, it wasn't impressive. It just wasn't. The pitching staff continues to be pretty good. Matthew Becker only threw an inning, did walk three, though, in that inning. Tyler Pitzer would come in and throw three in a herd and give up just two hits and a walk, and he was really good, and so was Ty Good. Ty Good, 1 2/3 following Pitzer, and didn't allow anybody on base before the rains hit, and they hit the showers. Dylan Brewer led off and had a pair of hits in the game, only four of them, though, in 21 at-bats for Gamecock baseball, plus eight more walks and five more strikeouts. And what that gets you to is a league-low batting average of .260. It's really been putrid, to be quite frank. Just 15 balls have left the yard this year for the Gamecocks, and Ethan Petrie and Cole Messina have been right in the thick of that. Although Messina would like to be stinging it a little bit more than he has been. But, offensively, I'll just be honest. They've really kind of been terrible when it comes to hitting it on the screws and where the other guys aren't. And so they're going to have to figure it out. I know that they're working on some things. They're too talented to be doing what they're doing and scuffling like that through 13 games. You know, they're almost a quarter of the way through the season, and offensively it's been pretty bad. So they're going to have to get it going, but the pitching staff is the second best in the league. According to the numbers, a 2.38 earned run average only trails Phil Texas A&M's unbelievable start. The Aggies are 13-0. With a 1.62 ERA team wide, and they collectively hit .321 so far. I mean, they are playing lights out. Oh, by the way, they've committed the third least amount of errors in the league this year, just 8 in 13 games. So, you know, they've been really good. South Carolina mirrors a lot of Ole Miss offensively, and that's not a good sign.
Yeah.
Ole Miss hits .264, which puts them second to last in the league. They both are fielding it at a .969 clip. That's not on, you know, from the offensive side of things, but they both have walked a league high 116 times. This is where the numbers stick out. And they both have been hit, one Ole Miss 26 times, Gamecocks 28. And Ole Miss has struck out 106 times, and the Gamecocks have struck out 110 times. So it's kind of scary because the offensive approaches are very similar, and they're not working. So I know that Monty and King and Joey Holcomb are working hard to get that shifted around. I mean, they changed the lineup a little bit yesterday, putting Brewer at the top and Leroy in the two-hole and starting Lee Ellis at second and hitting him in the nine hole. He did walk twice. So here they are, 13 games in. They felt like three, four, or five games in, they had some answers on the pitching staff, and they do. But they still got a lot of questions on the offensive side, and now would be a good time to address those.
Yeah, I mean, it's, you know, after this weekend, it doesn't get much easier, at least on the weekends. You know, you got some midweeks that are against, you know, average teams. But, I mean, again, you're in the toughest conference in the sport, more than likely, at the end of the year. So, you know.
Not more than likely.
Yeah, that's true.
100% likely. Yeah. There ain't a close second. No offense to the ACC, but there's not a close second.
No, but the good thing is like, you were worried heading into the season that pitching was going to be a struggle and that it would take, you know, all sorts of time to figure it out. And it has not. You've found what you needed, I think, from a starting standpoint, at least, to feel comfortable enough to head into league play. You've got some really, you know, good and hot arms that'll be coming out of the bullpen and giving you some really good innings stretch wise. So you've at least got that going for you. But here's the thing. If you can't win a 4-3 game, then what good does that do you? You know, last year you give a starting pitcher 3 runs and you can virtually just, you know, go home. But yeah, they need to find what they need when they're in the batter's box and start squaring up on some of these and hitting them where they ain't.
Now, I'll say this, the league overall has been a little underwhelming offensively. I mean, Alabama's hitting it as well as anybody, but just 6 teams are over 300 through 13 games. It's generally more than that. It's generally 8 or 9, 10, maybe sometimes. So a lot of teams out there really aren't swinging it well. And some teams that usually do swing it well, like this one, and Arkansas is down there at 285. You know, they've only hit 11 balls out of the yard, the Razorbacks have, which is a little surprising. Auburn is a team that's generally pretty offensive, only hitting 282 as a club. And these numbers can jump in a hurry. You know, if Longwood this weekend comes in here and South Carolina bangs out 10, 12 hits a game, all of a sudden you look up and they're hitting 290. You know, I mean, that can happen quick. But speaking from a baseball standpoint, you know, being the baseball guy that I am, my concern really is less about the average and more about the approach. Like they don't barrel a lot of balls up, and that's really not a good sign. You know, you watch baseball and you see balls hit hard into a gap or there's a line drive just right at him. You know, there doesn't seem to be a lot of competitive at bats when dudes are on base and things like that. This team's going to strike out. They're all striking out. I mean, to kind of put it into perspective, I mean, through 13 or 14 games for all of these teams here, you know, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, half the league has struck out over 100 times. I mean, Tennessee struck out 123 times in 14 games, but the difference is they're also hitting 327 as a team with 33 home runs and 130 ribbies. So they're and you know, they've only walked 78 times, but they're striking out a ton. But that right there is really an all or nothing approach. Like, but they barrel a lot of balls up. You know what I mean? Like they barrel a lot of balls up, and their runners in scoring position, you know, they swing it well. And that's been the problem, like not having competitive. It's okay to strike out. Like, that's going to happen. You have power arms now. It's a different game. Like, it's going to happen. If you're not having competitive at bats, you remember when Smoke was on opening day? And, you know, he said, you know what, you can read analytics, you can do all that stuff. But at the end of the day, like, you've got to be able to compete when you get in the box. You've got to be able to compete. And yeah. I just don't think that they've had enough competitive at bats through 13 games. And I'm quite sure that if Coach King or Monty or any of those guys were sitting here right now, they'd probably tell you the same thing. I mean, they'd probably tell me to tone it down a little bit, but you know, they have had competitive at bats. I'm not saying they haven't had one, But overall, this group is good of a hitters as they have in the lineup. They should be competing more. And that's got to start tomorrow.
Yeah. You need to start making some contact. I think, the walk total's good. I mean, you're getting free bags. Don't get us wrong. And that's a good at bat, don't swing it. What's bad. But I think being a bit more aggressive on some of that borderline stuff, kind of like what Coach Tanner was saying, being a bit more aggressive at the beginning of the count, when you kind of know what's coming at you, at least, with a higher percentage of what's going to be thrown at you, try to be a bit more aggressive there. And listen, I mean, it's like you said with Pat, your number three and number four hitters are all Americans.
Right.
This more than likely is going to work itself out. And you just need it to happen sooner rather than later. And I've got full confidence that this team will come around and start doing a bit better.
I just got the clearance to say this. The news of the day will be discussed more tomorrow. The Garnet Trust and Carolina Rise now joining forces as one NIL collective for the University of South Carolina. Carolina Rise and Garnet Trust together moving forward. This has been in the works for a long time, right, Phil? We'll allow JC and the guys from Garnet Trust, who we suspect will be on tomorrow with us, to kind of fill you in those details. But this has been going on for quite some time. We've just had to stay silent. But this is really good news for everybody. And we'll be able to kind of give you more of the details on that tomorrow and moving forward about how this is going to better impact and benefit the University of South Carolina, what our role will be in a lot of that. I can tell you, and I know we got to go, but I can tell you that JC is still going to be very, very involved. And that is a really good thing. And that South Carolina is extremely happy about all this and how it's all working out. So we're honored and proud to be able to say that as we wrap up here on a Thursday. Carolina Rise and the Garnet Trust together moving forward will make South Carolina better as one collective for the entire University of South Carolina. And again, this has been coming for some time. There's a lot of people probably think that, why wasn't this? Guys, there are a lot of things that you couldn't just say, let's just do this. There was a lot of stuff that had already been done from years ago that couldn't just be undone. They're called contracts, and they had to work through them to get to this point. But I can tell you that both Garnet Trust and Carolina Rise, what they have done individually to get to this point, has, if they didn't do what they did and save the things that were in place, we'd be in a lot worse place around here. I can promise you that. So hats off to everybody for making all this stuff. By the way, we did update this a couple of days ago if anybody hasn't paid attention on the app. So you can access the Garnet Trust right in the Chief Sports app now by pulling that up. So there you go. Thanks to Pat Bradley and Brad Muller. JC will be back tomorrow to discuss further the joint venture moving forward. And we've got Stuart Lake and much, much more to send you well into the weekend. College tournaments are underway. Enjoy them. Until tomorrow at 11. For Phil, I'm JB. We'll see you on Inside the Gamecocks, the show.